Live.
So welcome to our responders. Thank you so much for taking the time to hang out and be with us today. Thank hello online audience. I know you're out there because you told me you're going to be there. You better be there. Are you there, Dominic? Okay, I want to see some tweets from you. Okay, so we are also going to take, we're going to be tweeting some of the stuff that's being said, but we're also going to take questions from our online audience. So if you have questions, please use hashtag VAPF on your tweet, and then we'll get it. Okay. So welcome. This it's called Making Theater in a Messy World. In a messed up world. And a messy world. I don't mind the mess, but I don't like the messed up part. Okay, so, yes, and this title came from an article that Velina Brown wrote, who will be moderating this afternoon's conversation, that she wrote for the TBA. So we thank TBA and Velina for letting us steal her title. As I've been telling the responders today, I've been thinking about these questions we're asking for quite some time. It's come out of watching a lot of new work, reading a lot of new work, and meeting some amazing artists who have grown up in our community and are now making their own work. And I guess Javier is one of the prime examples, because I've known Javier since he was a teenager. And Nicole, since she maybe was also a teenager.
Teenish.
Yeah. So, thinking about, you know, my generation of artists
Who are you?
Amy Mueller. I'm the artistic director of Playwrights Foundation. And we're producing the Bay Area Playwrights Festival, so this conversation is part of that. So I've had a lot of questions about how new work is being made and why it's being made, and also the way in which I perceive that so-called political theater, socially relevant theater, has absolutely transformed in its form, and that speaks to a generation that you know, of my own children, essentially. And I'm really interested in having a dialogue. I was very interested in having a dialogue between generational artists. And so we've called together a group of amazing people who are giving us their time. And I'm going to ask each of them to introduce themselves to start off with, and what company, if there's a company you're with, or if there's some attribution you want to make to yourself. And then just talk a few minutes about the work that you do. That would be great. We can start with you, Richard.
My name is Bamuthi Montoya. I met Amy when we were 40, and I'm doing well. Richard Montoya. I work with a collective performance group called Culture Clash, and then as a solo playwright the last couple of years, I feel like I've really rededicated myself to this idea of maybe a flame holder and a flame thrower, and business is brisk. I mean, we'll get into it, hopefully, but political theater from not just my private writer's table, but to the public forum is on fire more than ever, I feel. And so hope to deconstruct some of that as we go. Culture Clash has been in Los Angeles for the last 20 years, but we were born in Galería de la Raza on 21st and Bryant in 1984. So despite my youthful appearance, we've seen a lot of movements come and go. And in 84 was really the tail end of many movements, and then other movements started. So it's been a wondrous journey, and really glad to be here today with you all.
Hi, I'm Kinan Valdez. I'm a lifelong member of the Teatro Campesino, which is, translates to the Farm Workers Theater. It's a theater company that was founded in 1965 during the middle of a labor strike. I grew up like a child of the circus, and so today my official capacity at the theater is the producing artistic director. But the way I see that is as the keeper of a set of community traditions, and those traditions, and I use that term lightly, but stem from certain decolonization efforts of the 1970s that have resulted in a series of philosophical practices that stem from ancient America. Mm-hmm. And those terms root the practice of the Teatro Campesino and all its manifestations today.
My name is Sean San Jose. I work for a company called Campo Santo and with Intersection for the Arts, where the company has been in residence pretty much since its beginning. We create on new work. I love the title of this building. I think that probably speaks for a lot of us, is probably why we do the work that we do, because it is a messed up world. I think it's a good way to respond to the world, to give voice to people whose voices don't get heard enough or a lot. And that's why the group Campo Santo was formed, to tell some of these stories. And I think the work that we've been able to do, especially what Intersection does, is trying to tell stories that I think are reflective and representative in some way of the neighborhoods we are in. We used to be in the Mission before it died, and then we moved downtown, and so now we're trying to figure out that neighborhood down there. So that's what we do.
My name is Ryan Nicole Peters. I am an actress, an activist, an athlete, and an artist. I guess we can call that theater today for the sake of the discussion. And in the activist capacity, I've worked as an executive director for an arts organization. I ran it for a few years and facilitated opportunities for young people to find their voice and express it in various settings. As an actress, I've worked with Campo Santo, Intersection for the Arts, California Shakespeare Theater, Colored Ink, in the very, very beginning, Playwrights Festival, in many different capacities as a writer and an actress. As an athlete, a little less pertinent to this conversation, except that you have to look good, I think, on stage. As an artist, I'm an MC, and I use hip hop as, I think, my most impactful medium to communicate my message of activism to a community who I think really, really hears it and really, really needs it. I feel like since we're using the word theater today, and since that's the conversation that I'm in, I think theater is something that I do by necessity. Less of a choice. I didn't elect to become a lawyer or a doctor or an actress for that matter. This has been a necessity. I grow up in the context that we discuss in the theater that I'm in and involved in. So it's a necessity.
Hi, my name is Margot Hall. I am a local actress and director, and I think I can say a playwright. Just completed my own book. I am also a co-founder with Sean San Jose at Campo Santo. And being a part of that company has given me so much to give to the Bay Area community as an actress and as a director. Working with Campo Santo kind of gave me this sense that I could do anything. And so I decided that I could do anything. And so I go out to any theater, and I work at all theaters. And I refuse to allow any discussion about I'm an African-American actress. I'm an actress. And I continue to push my voice loudly for diversity in the theater community, and not just on stage, but throughout the theater community, throughout the administration, throughout
this world, and I'm not talking about colorblind casting. I'm talking about the fact that all our stories are so important. And I find myself going more towards stories of family to really figure out how is it that where I came from, Detroit, Detroit is in the house. the idea of family and how foundation and structure, it comes in many different colors, it comes in many different shapes, and all of that needs to be expressed in the theater. And just excited to be an artist right now. Just excited to be an artist in the Bay. I've chosen to be in the Bay, and I'm very excited about that. I'm always excited about the work that Campo Santo continues to do, and look forward to continuing to be loud and proud.
Okay. So my name is Javier Reyes, and I'm a baby OG. What I mean by that is I got kids now who are graduating college. People start their own organizations, and I don't even think I'm that old. LeBron James. But I have a theater company I've had since 1999 called Colorique, hip hop theater company based, started out of Broadway Theater. Had a great 10-year run there. Saw the most incredible young and talented artists. Taught by the most incredible teachers for free 99, that no college could offer, I believe. Because they never separated theater and social justice. They were always married. And so I still carry that to this day. I also have another company called Urban Healing Tour, which is a faith-based company, so it's really dealing about, you know, we live in a messed up world, but we can have a great spirit if we choose. And that needs to be reflected on stage. There's a lot of spiritual, talented kids in this world. I truly believe the best playwrights are in jail right now. I say that because that's where I work at. I work at the theater inside of units where people are facing murder, rape, prostitution. And the stories that come out of there blow out anything that's on Broadway. I really feel like we need to create our own trip called Our Way. And that's why I really actually started doing theater, because I wanted to tell my story and other stories who related to mine. And at the time, the theater world didn't offer that. There was no avenue. There was no real door to express what I experienced as a young man in this world. And so it's been my lifelong commitment to pave that way and get these kids on the bulldozers themselves and create more lanes and highways and vehicles so that everybody's story can be told, not just the popular one or the one that gets redone every 5 years. We need some fresh meat up on the grill, and so that's what I'm here to deliver.
My name is Kimberly. I'm lucky enough to be one of the playwrights at the Bay Area Playwrights Festival this year. I'm currently based in Brooklyn, but I spent most of my formative years in Seattle. And I was, like many playwrights these days, I was a professional actress in Seattle. And I found my way to playwriting because the acting jobs that I was being offered were allowing me to use about that much of what I was capable of. And I felt a restlessness, and I was writing sort of all along, but I didn't show it to anybody because I didn't think of it as writing. And then a friend of mine encouraged me to, you know, have some people here with me, what could that hurt? So that's what I did, and that's kind of how I found my way. I'm really honored to be in this group of people. I think you're all amazing and doing amazing work, and I'm a little, confess, I'm a little startled to find myself sitting here. So thank you for having me.
Hi, I'm Velina Brown. I'm an actor, an occasional director, collective member of the San Francisco Mime Troupe, but I also work lots of other companies too. And I am a writer for Theater Bay Area Magazine, a monthly column, and features too. And I'm also a singer-songwriter, and so I do a lot of different things, but my artistic home for the past 20 years has been the San Francisco Mime Troupe. it has also helped me, similar to what you were describing, Margo, being part of a company does help you explore what your range is and what you're capable of doing, out of just necessity. Like, if this is gonna happen, everybody's gotta grab a piece and get it done. And then you realize that you actually can do it. I think I'll say a little bit more about how this came about later, so.
Hi, I'm Gene Sullivan. I'm an actor, director, and playwright, and based in the Bay Area. I'm also, I've been with the San Francisco Mime Troupe for 25 years now, and for 12 of them, I was a resident playwright. The Mime Troupe, for those of you who don't know, is a collectively run company that has done toured nationally and internationally, doing a lot of its free shows or indoor shows. The theater is really based on economic and social justice, with a heavy emphasis on the economic justice. Part of the philosophy really is that racial inequality, sexual inequality, much of the injustice that we see in the world is very much based on economics. Who has the power? Who has the money? Frequently, who has the power? How much does that outweigh any democratic or desire on the part of the people? As we, the workers in the country that have made the country, have made the world, why is it we don't have the power? And so our job is to activate the audience, not to necessarily give them answers, but to piss them off about the questions. I'm also, I work with different theater companies, like Margo said, and I also recently had a published play, an adaptation of 1984, which has been playing around the country, and tomorrow night I head off to Barcelona to do the Catalan translation of the play, and maybe the Spanish translation also. I'm kind of, focusing very much more on how much we can do with plays, not just with new shows, with old shows, to see everything through more of a political lens, and to make sure to always challenge the audience. Yeah, not pissing off the audience to a certain extent, making them mad at themselves for not doing more things. You gotta work harder. Anyway, that's me. Oh, and I'm married to her.
I'm Chloe Johnson with Symmetry Theater Company. I'm really inspired to hear so many stories here that I can relate to. I'm looking forward to talking to you all at the party afterwards. But I actually started out as an actor as well. And Symmetry started with myself and two other equity actors. We realized that as women, once we got our equity card, the work totally vanished. So for us, it made us upset that, and the Bay Area has a lot of hybrid situations where there's theaters where they hire equity and non-equity. And if there's a limited number of contracts, often they go to the men because of the play selection and a lot of other reasons. It's based on limited resources and all of that. But for us, it's an equal pay for equal work issue. And we felt like it shouldn't just be a hobby for us and a career with health insurance and pension for male equity actors. So we started Symmetry Theater Company. Our other goal was we were noticing the lack of strong and multifaceted female characters on the stage, and we thought we really do need some new meat on the grill. So our mission is twofold. We want to make sure there's a balance of equity contracts with the two genders, and also a balance of roles in terms of male and female characters, and that both gender roles are interesting and dynamic and show the complete picture. And we think it's not just important for actors who want to be working, but also for our community. It's essential that our community sees the whole picture, sees themselves, but a lot of audience, most audience members are women, see themselves on stage, represented well, and see, you know, good role models and good images of women. So that's what we do. I regret that we are have such a political mission. My biggest wish, I suppose, is that one day the gap will be closed and we'll be just another theater company. And that would be the best thing ever, really. But until then, we're, you know, doing our thing. We're small. We only do one show, one to two shows a year. So primarily at this stage, we're relatively new. We started in 2010. We're there to create an awareness and to keep the discussion out there and visible.
I'm Laura Shellhart. I'm a playwright who's based in Chicago. I'm also lucky enough to have my play at this festival this year. I'm also an educator. I teach theater at Northwestern University to undergrads. It's alongside writing my other equal passion. My work has, in the past couple years, also I've sort of experienced a shift in process. My last few plays have involved going out into whatever community the play subject warrants and doing interviews with the people there. My last play was about the death penalty and involved talking to people in the prison system, talking to lawyers, talking to women, going into women's prisons. The play that is up here is about women leadership. So it involved talking to a lot of female entrepreneurs, women in small businesses, women in the academic world. And it's interesting you talk about your impetus, Chloe, because I think my impetus for starting to write was actually to write more roles for women, more diverse roles for women, and roles for women of all ages. So that's, for the past few years, been my focus.
I'm sitting in the right section. Hi, my name is Christine Young. I'm a director and an educator. I used to work at the Playwrights Foundation for several years with Amy, so I'm a huge fan of the Barry Playwrights Festival. So I started as a director and just sort of an artist, and I met Afa Fugard when I was 18, and didn't know that theater could do the kinds of things that his plays do, and so that was sort of my conversion experience. And then I directed a lot of plays about ethnic cleansing and the Japanese internment and sort of light subjects like those. And it was really exciting and meaningful to me, but at a certain point, as I got older, it sort of didn't feel sufficient to just direct plays and to just sort of have an artistic engagement with these really big issues. And I wanted to have a different kind of impact. And so I now teach at the Performing Arts and Social Justice Program at the University of San Francisco. So I'm really primarily an educator. And I spend my days teaching students about Teatro Campesino and the Mime Troupe, and trying to kind of rewrite or sort of author an alternative theatrical history for a group of students who are training to be theater artists, and try to expand their ideas about what theater is and can be and can do in the world. We do a lot of community-based work. We work in the San Bruno County Men's Jail. We work with seniors. We do lots of arts education work. So this idea of artist activist is very important to us. And one of the things I'm noticing as I get older is I think I always had a lot of separation in my mind between these different roles, you know, slashes. And now they're starting to really blend together for me. And I no longer am sort of thinking, well, that's professional art, or that's community-based art, or that's, you know, I'm starting to realize that actually what we're all engaged in is an effort to transform the culture and to create a more just and equitable and peaceful world for everyone. So that's me.
I like what my seatmate just said when she said conversion experience, because I feel like the thing that I'm interested in getting into a little bit in this conversation is where our different intentions and goals lie in relation to our interests in converting or engaging or partnering with or collaborating with. I think that's a really nice term that we could pick apart and maybe get in some juicy conversations and even arguments about this afternoon. My name is Michael Rode, I'm going to watch as they murmur over there. I'm really honored to be sitting in this semicircle with this group of people, because there's a lot of people here that I've known a long time and have admired their work and the work of their companies and their individual work, and there's a lot of people here I'm really excited to meet. And I was trying to think about my own conversion experience. I run something called Sojourn Theater, which is a 15-year-old ensemble-based theater company. We started in Virginia in the late 90s. We spent almost 10 years in Portland, Oregon. There are 15 of us. We now live in 8 cities around the United States and are working constantly. We have 8 projects going on right now, led by different company members in different places. We're always together in different combinations working on projects. And I feel like rather than talk about what we do, I could give like 4 super quick examples. So one of our projects is we're working in Milwaukee with homebound seniors who are homebound due to health reasons and also economic reasons, are isolated. We're working with their caregivers, Goodwill, who delivers food to them, public transit, and the Department of Public Health. And we're doing creative work in the homes with the folks who are homebound, and working and using the work that comes out of that to catalyze public conversation about policy related to social isolation and economics. And that's going to result both in lots of small projects and large performances that happen in downtown Milwaukee 2 years from now. Working with Catholic Charities USA around the United States, we're artists in residence for 2.5 years, and we're working at poverty reduction sites around the country where we're doing interviews, creating performance, giving workshops on collaboration, and we are using performance tactics to host public dialogue in communities about poverty. We're working with planning commissions around the country. We developed something called BILT, which is a participatory civic planning game based in story sharing and facilitation. And we've been working in rural and urban communities with planning commissions to use these tactics to host conversations about resource allocation. And it's government agencies bringing the public together to have more creative and dynamic conversations so more voices are in those conversations around decisions. And we have a project called How to End Poverty in 90 Minutes, which is a performance model that we've done in Chicago that's going to go to some other places soon, where we work with local community partners, local artists, and students on creating events where audiences of a couple hundred have to decide over the course of 90 minutes how to take part of the box office and use it to fight poverty in their community. And the actual money sits on stage in a big glass bubble, and by the end of the show, the money gets spent. And it's spent in relation to community cameos that happen through the structure. So I'm really interested in different dramaturgies around participation, both in the partnering process as well as in the production of new work. And I think the only other thing I'd say is, I spent the 90s living out of a suitcase. I founded an organization called Hope is Vital in Washington, D.C., working with men and women who were living on the street with HIV and or AIDS. And I started that project in D.C. in 91. And then I spent 8 years living out of a suitcase, working with communities around the country on starting ensembles of men and women living in that context, partnering with schools or arts organizations. And then I started Sojourn with a group of people. And I feel like I'm constantly trying to find my way as a theater artist in our field back into contexts where the kind of listening that I felt like I got to do, doing that super grassroots community-based work, can exist in a lot of the distribution networks and systems that theater gets formally built and shared in. So that's me.
My name's Joan Holden. Earlier this week, there was an event where the playwrights in the festival were asked to tell their life story in 5 words. I was late and I didn't have to do mine, but I thought of what I would say. That my story would be Vietnam War, Contra War, Gulf War, invasion of Iraq, global warming. And then I thought, no, that's not really true. Probably the last word would be gentrification. Mm-hmm. And then I thought more generally, all those wars and class. I also had spent a long time in the San Francisco mine group from 1967 to 2000, which meant opening a new sapphire every year on the 4th of July. always a sapphire, always comedy, because because that's what lets people confront, or at least for us, there's two reasons you write comedy. One is a kind of bent personality. That's just how you are. And the other is that people, laughter lets people look at things that normally they want to look away from. So for a subject like, you know, for example, my favorite example is Israel and Palestine. Mm. We did a mistaken identity farce. Michael played both the Israeli and the Palestinian hero in 1988, the year before Oslo. And, you know, the painful subject, the subject that no one could deal with, the subject that nobody wanted to see, and enormously people wanted to be able to laugh about it, wanted to be able to relax. So I spent 30 years writing satire, and people, serious people, would often ask, well, are you ever going to write a real play? Oh, it's fine, but are you ever going to write a serious play? And my answer is that serious and comic are not opposites. The opposite of comic is straight. The opposite of serious is trivial. It has nothing to do with comedy. Can absolutely be completely and totally serious. So I write serious comedies, which have involved a lot of interviewing, a lot of, you know, research into different kind of scenes and hearing different kind of people's stories, but then always turning them into something nutty, not docudrama, something crazy. And I notice in myself, now that around 70, the satiric impulse started to wane. And now I more write plays that celebrate things. For example, I wrote a play that celebrated diner waitresses. Mm-hmm. And now I got the commission of a lifetime to do the stage adaptation of Nickel and Dimed, Barbara Ehrenreich's book. So that was getting into a lot of lives of low-wage workers. And probably that was transformational for me. So now I'm working in a more natural, for me, very naturalistic, but still, for most people, very broad style, and that I don't have that slash and burn impulse to write satire. So I hope younger people do, because it needs to be written. But I'm writing other stuff now.
I'm Lindsay Crumbine, and I have a one-year-old theater company. Woo-hoo. Called Pretty City Repertory Youth Theater. It's ensemble-based theater in Oakland, and we work with 14 to 20-year-old youth, pretty much all from Oakland Public Schools or recent graduates of Oakland Public Schools, virtually all of whom come with no experience in theater, most of whom haven't seen a play. And so that's really exciting. I actually was a teacher for the last 12 years at Mission, Michelle, in San Francisco, and most recently at Oakland Tech. And my conversion happened when I was 6 and I saw the Comedy of Errors at Oregon Shakespeare Festival, and just people peering around pillars all wild-eyed. I was just totally enraptured and wanted to be a part of that. But never did theater growing up, was an athlete, and then sort of became an educator against my will. My whole family is full of educators. I was never going to be an educator. It just happened anyway. But in teaching in very heterogeneous classrooms with kids anywhere from pretty much non-readers to a college reading level, all in the same high school classroom, and I found that Shakespeare was the great equalizer because nobody understood. But we shut the tables and put on hats, and everyone loved it. It was always everyone's favorite thing because Shakespeare, definitely, I love it, and we always do it instead of reading it. And I started various after-school theater production groups at all the schools where I taught, and then they closed for one reason or another, you know, tend a lot, you know, just all the things where schools aren't stable in their funding. And so finally I was like, you know, it's always successful, it works with the kids, I'm just gonna do it, I'm gonna do it myself. So I'm doing that now, it's very new. I've just quit my day job. So we're doing it. Yeah, so, and actually I also have a brand new baby, so I have two babies, my 4-month-old and my company. It's all pretty exciting. But I was at a workshop with Michael years and years ago when I first sort of started doing theater with youth and learned tons and have since integrated a lot of his practices into the work. And I think I come from a place of where it's less important what play we're doing and more important sort of all the amazing things that come out of the rigor and community of doing theater as ensemble work. And that, you know, every, I'd say probably 95% of the youth that I've worked with end up saying after 3 or 4 months, we're a family, it's a family, it's our community, everyone has each other's backs. And so we have youth from all over Oakland, all different schools working together 6 hours a week, rehearsing, getting there on the bus, there's no like credit or anything, and just doing it for the love of it. And I think for me, the social justice aspect is about access. It's about, I don't know, Oakland's having a tough time, you know, but at the same time, there's this renaissance, so there's all this excitement. But really, if you look at the stats on, you know, public school kids, they're not improving, and the graduation rates, and who's incarcerated, and all of that. And these are the kids that are doing Shakespeare, among other things, and also modern work. And I think that doing that deep work with kids, we're really small. And sometimes people are like, oh yeah, we can't give you a grant because you're only serving 13. And I'm like, yeah, but I have to be able to get my arms around all of them at the same time. We can't do that with 150 people. So it's exciting. And I also was really sort of stunned when I was invited to do this and looked at the list of people and everyone's like, yes. So I'm really excited to be here and honored and really excited to hear what you all have.
Hi, I'm Dale Orlando Smith. I'm out of New York, and I'm best known for a play called Yellow Man. I was here last year doing a play called Black and Blue Boys, Broken Men, which was a co-pro between Berkeley Weapon and Goodman. And I have a new piece that's coming up called Forever, which is going to be done at the Taper. I began to write, I'm 53, so I go back to the 80s and stuff like that, 70s and the 80s. And I began to write because of the lack of roles for women of color. How many ways can you say ho? There's not too many ways you can say that. And, you know, back in the 80s, it was a whole thing about, you know, like, there was the musical and all of that. So, again, I began to write for my type, not fitting in, you know, like being this, like, small little girl I never was. You know, and also, again, for other people's expectation of what it means to be black and female. I'm like you. It's a given that I'm black and female. Within the course of the day, maybe I'm listening to Jay-Z, maybe I'm listening to Monteverdi. You know, maybe I'm listening to the Racketeers, maybe I'm listening to the Velvet Underground. So when people try to compartmentalize, this is what my beef is. And again, having, in terms of the political, I don't know whether I am in the ways that all of you are. I'm hoping that my individualism does add to a collective, because I'm hoping, you know, because we need to look at how, you know, again, the good thing about groups is that you're not alone. The bad things about groups is that sometimes your individualism is shoved to the side. So there's that. There's also that has to be looked at too, because I've also dealt with that. When I wrote this play, Yellow Man, that deals with internal racism, the majority of people have been were very, very, you know, very receptive and very, you know, there are people that are glad that I wrote it. There was a certain amount of racism. You know, certain white people said, I didn't know you people did this. And meanwhile, again, like when I talk about universalism, every group of people do it. You know, I've heard Northern Italians talk about Southern Italians, the rift between, and I grew up in El Barrio, so although racially I'm black, New Yorican is my, you know, my culture. So like you'll hear people, you know, say, you know, you're so Boricua, pero, you know, like in terms of like, the motherfucking Cuban motherfucker over there. It's like, yo, what are you doing, man? You know, and then, you know, I'm also of West Indian descent, so you've got like the American side that was knocking the Caribbean side. And also, you know, again, I'm interested in what is in fact universal. So, and also the way Black and Blue Boys was written, where anyone of any race can do it, you can be any gender and can do it, and it could be single character, multi-character. So if there is a political within that, I suppose that's it. Because if we're going to talk about the unification of theater, these are the boundaries that have to be broken down. Our perceptions of who we think the other one is. So, thank you, Vida.
And one more responder here. Please introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Toranje Gazarian. I'm the founding artistic director of Bold and Twin Productions. So we were a company focused on the Middle East, and we began talking about a Middle Eastern American voice when there was no Middle Eastern American voice to be promoted, I guess. And 15 years later, we are proud to have built a community of playwrights, actors, designers, writers, and all sorts of...
And allies.
And allies. And personally for me, theater has been, like so many of all of us, a way to survive, really, and a way to reject sort of the tendency to reduce us to identity or ethnicity or gender. Theater's been a way to talk about the complexity of the individual and the complexity of the human being. And activism for me is kind of a way to fall in love, really. It's less of a rejection and less of being angry and more a way to bring people together around the table and have a meal and find joy in the fact that we're alive. So theater serves all of those needs and creates opportunities for getting together and enjoying life and addressing the things that don't work in life. So here we are.
Hey, good. Very quickly, I'd just like to go around the room and just say your name, two or three words, literally, putting yourself into social space. Just so we know who's here with us. You can start way back there. Yeah. Nice and loud, please.
Yeah, okay. Three words or five words? Asian Religions and Culture Theater, UC Berkeley, 60 to 70. I mean, not 65 to 70. Center for the Study of Law and Society, job now. And writing plays. That have to do with, well, it's not getting too many words. Mm-hmm. Writing plays. Two plays have been written and produced.
And your name is?
Meg.
Meg. Okay. Moving on. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Caitlin. Dramaturg, fellow, and emerging everything.
I didn't do the intro, but hey, I'm Erin Merritt, director, dramaturg, producer, etc.
I'm Nicole Palm. Newbie intern at Playwrights Foundation.
I'm Sonia, I'm an intern at Playwrights Foundation, aspiring playwright, singer, actress, love television, film, theater, music, dance, art.
I'm Chanel, also an intern, future playwright, lawyer, performer, mover and shaker.
I'm Katie Fahey. I'm with the Kenneth Raymond Foundation. I'm a program associate for the arts. I'm an arts administrator. And we fund dance and theater.
I'm Jerry Rosenblum, past filmmaker, present virtual world.
My name's Johnny Mercer. I'm a company member with Shotgun Players in Berkeley. Just a thrill to see all you guys and be in this space today and be part of this conversation. Shotgun certainly involves itself with the stories within its own community. We are developing another piece right now called Berkeley Stories, Berkeley Play that our friend Danny Wolf is writing right now. So I just wanted to come here and represent and be part of this conversation today. Thank you.
My name is Eric. I'm from San Jose. A year or two ago, at a similar symposium, they had suggested...
Just one or two words.
Oh, okay. A website. Anyway, I have a website on WordPress through one of these symposiums. Okay. I think that was a great idea.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bernard Vosch. I teach... I'm a clown. I'm an actor. Teach voice work to actors and moving artists and dancers. Do fight choreography.
Hi, I'm Nicole Lucero. I'm a writer and a filmmaker, and I'm really interested in using film as a way to address like political themes, so I'm really excited to be part of this conversation.
I'm Regina Sneed, avid theater goer, subscriber, donor, former past life board member, People's Theater Coalition, and Life on Water.
Thank you.
Anybody who's around that?
Hi, my name is Sarah. I'm a visual artist and a theater educator.
I'm Andrea, I'm a playwright and director and educator.
I'm Danielle Mayock, I'm a student, I'm a potential playwriter, potential screenwriter, and also a student of Dale's right now.
Chaz Belov, pre-emerged playwright, volunteer for the Playwrights Center of San Francisco.
Hi, I'm Luana. I used to act with Javier and Margo. I'm a student, I'm a writer, and an upcoming documentary filmmaker.
I'm Smiley, I'm a poet, emerging playwright, emerging theologian at some point. I recently got my BA in Performing Arts and Social Justice from USF under Christine. focusing on theater and social justice and spoken word and social justice.
I'm Carol Lashoff, and I've been an intermittently emerging playwright for 35 years, and I'm also a parent and an educator.
I'm Erica, but I'm just really grateful to be here.
I'm Colleen Egan. I'm an actor, and I'm an associate artist and board member for Gritty City Repertory Youth Theater. Mm-hmm.
I'm Erin Katea. I'm a playwright, an engineer, and a mother of twins.
I'm Elizabeth Benedict. I'm a writer and an actor, and was produced by Golden Fred recently.
Hi, my name is Michael Bogar. I'm a recent Del Arte graduate working with Bond Street Theater and Clowns Without Borders and Del Arte.
I'm Jamie Talley. I used to do program management for youth radio. I performed for 5 years with the Coco Biscayne. I taught for a few years. I just got my master's in arts education. I'm working with Jean on starting an organization with Applied Theater and youth development. Okay.
Jean Johnstone, mom, Applied Theater, Action, Oaklandese.
My name is Megan. I'm a high school special education teacher, and I'm working with Jean on the Applied Theater and getting that into schools.
I'm Ann Hallinan. 100 years ago, I worked for the Mime Troupe. Then, a dozen years ago, I went back to acting. My first gig was at the Teatro Campesino, and since then, I've worked with anybody who'll hire me.
Hi, I'm Ginny Reed, and I'm a director, dramaturg, and educator, and generally an appreciator.
Charmin Hilfinger. I'm a playwright and producer, and founder of Bootstrap Theater Foundation.
Tatiana Chatterjee, fight choreographer and martial artist, improviser, playback theater artist, educator with youth around military, anti-military recruitment in Oakland. Also a lot of Bengali theater, kind of physical abstract forms.
Rich, I'm a retired teacher, playwright, poet, and some of you may remember years ago Red Balloon Theater Company, which I was part of.
Four of us are members of a fledgling group from Tehillah Synagogue in Oakland. Playwright, triple threat, adding directing to that, although I have directed. I want to get serious about it. And here's our project manager.
I'm Norma Smith. We're working on an intergenerational and cross-community
collection of family immigration stories, which we're going to turn into performance pieces, multi-genre, working out of Oakland. It's an East Bay project. We're working with a lot of different organizations that do immigration justice and storytelling.
My name is Rochelle Towers, all of that, and still looking to make revolution through stories.
My name is Mary McElroy. I was a bilingual and ESL teacher in Eastside San Jose. I am into transformative arts integration, curriculum design. I am a poet and a playwright and a writer for change.
Michael Austin, audience member. Husband to Ryan Nicole.
David Oler, I'm an intern at the Playwrights Foundation, doing the Twitter stuff.
Both are Garcia, videographer, filmmaker, and go see Fruit Bell Station in theaters nationwide today.
Yes.
Woo. Okay, we got everybody. All right, good. That was really moving. I think the panel is over. I'm going to introduce Velina Brown to start us off.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you want me to get people at the table and explain how we're going to do this, or?
What I wanted to do is talk a little bit about just how this.
Sure. Yeah. Why don't you come up into the light?
Okay. All right. I feel like. So. Share a little bit about how, you know, theater in a messed up world came about. Is this a good spot?
Yeah.
So as I mentioned, I write this column for Theater Bay Area magazine, and I also teach a goal setting workshop for TBA's Atlas program. And this latest one that I taught, the Atlas program provides training and then offers an opportunity to apply for grants for actors, and now they've added directors and playwrights. But started off with this amazing thing for actors to kind of get their act together, so to speak. And so I'm teaching this goal setting workshop that I've been teaching for some time now, for 4 years for them. And I take them through this process. And this young artist who, I guess she was, you know, 20 something, and she started to have, you know, a reaction to doing the process, the goal setting process. And she just said, I'm stuck because there are so many things wrong in the world, and I'm not really sure that the path I'm on as an artist, as an actor, makes any sense at all right now. The ice caps are melting, Australia's on fire. You know, like, what am I, does this even make sense for me to be sitting here making a plan of how to proceed as an actor? Is that really the best thing that I could be doing with my time and energy as a human being at this point in human history? Okay. That's what she's asking me. And I feel happy enough with my answer in the moment. But I kept thinking about that, and I decided, you know, a lot of people are probably having this question right now. And so I ended up writing to her and asking her to say a little bit more and to respond to her in the magazine, in my column. And so just the process of thinking about this, you know, because there are a lot of things going on that are messed up, and really, so I just, in a nutshell, my response to her and anybody about this is that I think it doesn't really matter that much whether you're an actor or a firefighter in Australia or whatever. I think it's important to be doing what you're passionate about. If you can be happier and more fulfilled doing something else, the stock answer to anybody considering acting, if you can be happy doing anything else, do that, because this is really hard. But if this is the thing that you really want to be doing, that you're passionate about doing, then give it all you've got. But to focus on, well, what is the work I'm doing as an artist? Because certainly you can be doing work that feels pointless, you know, and frivolous and overly fluffy if you're tuned into the polar ice caps, right? Or you can decide to utilize your talents to talk about that and to help address those issues. I don't think that there is a more powerful way that you can address these things. And there's all kinds of examples of that, you know. And so...
Sitting right here.
Exactly. So I don't think the student who asked me that question is here today. But this, I sort of see this as an opportunity for a sort of a 3D answer to that question. You know, what is the point or value of doing theater in a messed up world? And so this is a pretty amazing collection of people who have, many of whom have dedicated their whole lives, their life's work to doing just that. And then people who are embarking on that now. And so, you know, the point is not to convince someone to be or do anything in particular, but to just decide to get clear within themselves who they are, what their mission is, and the vehicle that they want to, you know, execute that mission. So to start off, we have these two parts. We had this idea of talking with Amy and Aaron about this event and generating names of people that would be really cool to talk to about, and you guys showed up. And so let's start with the first round table.
So I'm going to be calling people to sit at the table, and Velina's going to ask each a question, and each of them will respond to the question. You can use the microphone since you're going to not be facing people, and you just pass it around. And but you don't have to, but it's there if you need it or want it. And but the point is to talk to each other and for us to listen attentively and actively. And then you can ask questions of one of the people at the table in between. We're not going to take too many questions so that we can move on. And then whoever's at the table will sit down and another group will come up and Velina will probably ask another question to move the conversation along for this section.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to have Richard, Montoya, Taranj, Margot, Kinan, Lindsay, Joan, Javier, Kimber. Is that eight? Ready? And if you're so uncomfortable, just move around to the side, okay? Move around to the side.
I'm cool.
All right.
Very dramatic.
So the first chunk of this is about you as individuals, and some of you have already expressed some of this, but maybe you can go a little bit further into it. How you as an individual came to be an artist that we have identified as political artists. You know, so you could talk about whether or not you agree with that identification. But you're here because we see that. So how did you come about that as a person? Was it something that you knew as a young person that this was what you were going to do? You were going to do political work or social justice kind of inflected work? Or is it something that over time that you just discovered that that's what you were drawn to or
leaning toward or whatever, like maybe a little bit about how, about that. And maybe you could also talk about what you consider political. So I'm gonna just say this one thing. I believe that all theater is political. I believe that all art is political. Whether the person who's creating is necessarily intending that or not, the effect is, because either you're questioning or challenging the status quo, or you are upholding the status quo in some way with your work. That's my belief. So therefore, whether you think you're a political artist or not, I think you are. but you know, upholding or challenging the status quo is the thing. So anyway, so who would like to start? How did you find yourself being the person, the artist that you are right now? How did that happen?
So we can really hear it. You guys can talk to each other. So talk to each other. And we're just
listening. Let's just project.
Okay.
Be loud. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I grew up thinking, I mean, I always assumed that I had to do something to make the world better. You know, from a small child. But I also like to write. And it never occurred to me that those two things could go together, you know. So I thought to be a writer, you had to have really interesting, fascinating experiences. And I tried to have them, but I never finished anything. I'd start poems and never finish them, and start short stories and never finish them. Then one day in the Vietnam, and I thought, okay, I guess I'm not going to be a writer. I'll get my master's in social work. And then I got a chance to adapt a script to be a satire on the war in Vietnam. That was in 1967. And then I found out that I could put my whole self, everything that I felt and knew, into writing plays, into speaking to people that way, to yelling, really, and expressing rage in a very indirect way. And that was it.
I have a
go next. I grew up in Detroit, and I grew up in a musical family. My stepfather was the arranger and producer for the Supremes, so I grew up in Motown world. So I was always a performer. But I also was very, stubborn and upset about things not going the way I thought they should go. And I became very fond of Angela Davis at a very young age. and growing up in Detroit, you know, I grew up in the Black Mecca. I mean, again, where my family was, where I grew up, but I found that whenever I went outside of that world, there was all this racial injustice. And I went to a gymnastic camp once in Adrian, Michigan. And again, I always grew up with the sense that I could be whatever I wanted to be. That's what my mother told me. So that was the truth. And so I just thought I could go anywhere and do anything. And I would be accepted because I was a good person and I was good at whatever I was trying to do. And I went to this camp, and these people started treating me very poorly. And I was like, I don't understand, what's the problem? And they started talking about my hair, and why couldn't I and I was very young, I think I was like 8 or 9. Why couldn't I swim in the pool without a swimming cap? And then the actual counselors were abusing me. Like, they would make fun, you know, when you're doing gymnastics, you gotta run and someone has to help you, spot you, and they would let me fall and they would laugh. And I was like, what the hell, why is this? Then there was another counselor. Oh, I forgot to tell you, I was the only Black girl there out of 500 girls. So finally, the counselor took me under her wing, And I could no longer be with anyone else. And she taught me everything. And eventually I realized, okay, I see what's going on here. And I decided to say, well, you know what? If you can't accept me for who I am, I'm going to really be who I am. So I braided my hair. I just became the Black Nubian queen. And everyone started following me. How did you do that to your hair? What is your life about? And so I was like, well, I actually don't feel like telling you about it. It's a very wonderful, beautiful thing. So right away, I realized the power that I had as an African American. And I just embraced that for the rest of my life. And again, I was always performing because I was singing with the Supremes. I was writing. I had a talk show in my bedroom. So I was always doing both. And so the more I got into theater, I started finding that vehicle to express that Angela Davis, finding that vehicle to express the beauty of being this wonderful, talented, beautiful African-American woman, and trying to find opportunities to continue to show that. And a lot of that I did and continue to do on stage. And it may not even be a part that's geared to an African-American, but whatever I am, I'm that 100% out of me. And that's what I bring to the table. And so I'm constantly trying to find ways to let other people know that that's a good thing and that everyone should be able to bring 100% of themselves to the table at all times.
So I'll jump in. Again, I alluded to, I grew up as a child at the theater. My first memories are actually traveling with the Teatro Campesino troupe. And the reason why I know this is because I had an accident when I was 3 years old. I fell on a touring bus, split my head open. This was in a little hamlet outside of Paris at an international communist festival. There was no hospitals nearby. And so I was carried into this little emergency tent, and they had no anesthesia, and the doctor stitched 3 stitches into my head. And my parents puked after this incident. For me, it was the blessing, because that's my first memory of being on the road with this traveling troupe, being held and embraced, and everybody rushing to take care of me in that moment. So I saw the beauty of humanity as my first memory. It was not just about my parents, but was also about all the people who were working in that morning to take care of me. I grew up in a theater company that has been a blessed experiences. I got to see Richard and Montoya Culture Clash perform as a young boy. I've got to see all the San Francisco Mime Troupe players over the years. I am a blessed individual when it comes to practicing political theater. And so it's my responsibility as an individual to feed that community. From here on out, I see myself as a keeper of community traditions. Well, in this case, this is my community, right here, right now. Part of the principles that the Teatro Campesino instilled in my generation, the first generation that was able to grow up with it, was one Mayan concept called in la quech. In la quech means you are my other me. It is the principle, the fact that we all have to cultivate the sense of being pure reflections of each other, to recognize that we all have that same sacred humanity in each of us, but part of that is the idea of instilling the practice of solidarity in everything you do. This term, in la quech, appeared as part of the work of the Zapatistas in the 1990s. It is now part of the popular discourse because it was one of the teaching practices in Tucson, the Mexican-American studies curriculum that had been banned with other people's work. So it is a notion that we all must cultivate. And so I just want to say that I appreciate being here in this particular space with all of you in this very human moment.
One of the things that really resonated with me that you said, Velina, was that you have to do what you're most passionate about. And I feel like I really do theater with youth for totally selfish reasons. And I think that's actually really good. It's just the most fun, wonderful, joyous part of work that I've ever had. And I
I taught at three different schools and then ended up actually with my first son, who's 4 years old now, was planning to go half-time and still do after-school theater production, and sort of at the 11th hour, this charter school wouldn't give me a part-time job, and I had actually helped found the school, and it was really crushing, and so it was like, come back full-time with a five-week-old baby or no job, and so I... Okay, and so then I took a year off and sort of figured out where do I want to go from here, and tried to do a lot of brainstorming about what I loved best, and it was really the ensemble, it was the after-school ensemble work that just gave me this pure joy, and where I felt like it was the best work that I did, and that the kids I was working with got so much out of it, and so did I. And I think that one of the reasons that it's really successful is that the youth that I work with see that I'm having such a great time and working so hard, and that it's not this like, I'm in charge, well I am, but but it's, there isn't that division, we're all, I'm down on the floor just as much as anyone is, we're all, you know, bruised and sweaty and in it together, and I think one of the things that's really important to me is sort of wrangling kids that don't look good on paper, but have all kinds of fire and intellectual curiosity, and for whatever reason, nothing has like hooked them. And I tend to be one of those teachers that hooks those kids, because I'm like, oh, I see you, and you're not getting away with this like failing thing. It's not happening. But unfortunately, you know, if, like at Oakland Tech where I've been working, you look at the honors and the AP classes and it's like horrifyingly segregated. And I was always one of those teachers that would have instantly in the first week of school pull all these kids up into honors. I'm like, oh, no, 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 you're a reader. This is not, well, I failed English last year. I don't care. You're not going to fail this year because you're, I can tell you have it. And so a lot of the kids I end up working with are the kids who haven't been successful academically, but they should be, you know, but they're not. But then they're just rocking Shakespeare. And you're like, okay, so I feel like it's really important. And I try and find ways to support them academically so they can get grades, so they can pass classes and graduate, because that's all important too. But I think that giving people intellectual pursuits and stimulating their intellectual curiosity with real, rigorous, challenging, relevant, exciting work is what I love so much. And then we also like, just have so much fun doing combat and physical theater and all that kind of thing. And like I said, I grew up being lucky enough going to Oregon Shakespeare Festival every summer since I was like in utero. My family would go with a group of people and we'd stay in the dorms there and just go see all the plays, and it's been really incredible. I'm actually going like 3 days for my, 37th year, I think. So
how did you know that you were going to, how did you get into?
Shakespeare worked in my classroom, and Mission High School had no drama because there was no money. And so I was like, okay, well, let's start an after-school drama program. And then I had a good friend who did theater and sort of was a good mentor for me, Gina Grandi, who did a ton of work here and is in New York now. And we did The Tempest with 9 people, and it was awesome. And people were blown away. And I just loved it. So I was like, okay, let's do more of this. And then when grading papers for 5 English classes and doing theater production was too much, I tried to move more into the drama world and less into just straight up teaching. But I don't know, I just think that it's so stimulating. It's just what I'd rather do than anything else.
What everybody said, and I mean, it's interesting in the U.S. how we separate politics as if it's this sort of entity that is this separate thing. I've never had that luxury. I was born in Iran. I was sort of pushed into the U.S. when I was 14 as a result of a political act of the people of the
country, and my family was displaced, and we had to start from zero. And this idea of somebody saying I'm not political or politics doesn't affect me just makes no sense to me. So I've never had that luxury of separating those things, separating politics from my life. It's always been a part of our family life, and as I've grown older and sort of interacted with more people, what has been beautiful about theater is how it gives you a space to celebrate, like Joan said, all of who you are. And in my case, even in Iran, I was kind of an outsider because I come from a mixed background family of Muslim and Christian. And coming here, that was just too complicated to explain to people. And then growing up in the US, trying to sort of work as a professional theater artist, you know, going to auditions or wanting to pursue graduate school, I was actually told that I would never be cast in a leading role in professional American theater because of my accent, because of my looks, and probably also because of my preference of the pieces that I was drawn to. And so that sort of really limited the options I had in terms of theater. I was, in a way, forced to write my own material, in a way, forced to direct and produce material that I liked, and sort of by default, I created a space for other artists like me who hadn't, to that point, found a space where they could be all of who they are. And they could express stories of their lives and their perspectives in a space where audiences were interested and artists were interested and able to sort of bring those stories to life. So that's sort of how my work came about.
I can't wait anymore. you know, a political act for me can be potentially an act of love, you know, and I see, without being too grandiose, I see the more political that my work is, it's an act of love of which there's a price to pay. There's been a, even though we've been fortunate to have our my plays produced, there's still an institutional isolation that goes on that baffles me. And there was an East LA Playwrights Roundtable the other day in the weekend, and I was like, how many times can this group meet and not invite culture clash to this thing? Like, what is going on, you know? That's another matter, and I'm not here to settle that score whatsoever, but I just know that in this messed up, increasingly ADD world that I've kept my hand on a tiller, and where it's steering is and where I might even differ and separate from the culture clash boys is that I would be methodical about the work. And that so when Kidan's dad had us stop by the Fresno storefront in 67, and the Vincent Emmels Brigade is back there carving Che Guevara wooden medallions, and six Montoya kids sit down with my mom and my dad, my mom from Fowler, California, that's where my parents met and married, that when the teatro at that moment sat us down to do my dad's poem in Louis, it was nothing but, if not an act of love, you know. The most brilliant version of my dad's poem, indelibly etched in my, you know, I think at that moment we're the same age. But it's important, you know, that at that age, that young, seeing the beauty of teatro, live music, celebrating the most vilified members of our community. My dad grew up watching. My dad grew up kind of shoe shining the pachucos, you know, and talk about the vilification of that set. Like Joan said something earlier about perhaps I don't think my satirical things have mellowed, but I'm after new things in my work. It is proudly and unapologetically political, but I'm also restless to find a grace in a violent world, to find ritual and ceremony in the work. We did that with the river at Campo Santo. It came up again in American Night, Kel Shakes, which started at Oregon Shakes, went to Yale, blah, blah, blah. When August Wilson came to see Chavez Arin for the second time, and he was writing and dying. He was writing Gem of the Ocean at the Tate Bird, and when he came the second night, that was transformational for me. And I gave myself permission at that second to write in cycles, that the immigration story couldn't be told in a single piece. The Chicano, like odd Mr. Wilson's Pittsburgh, it just cannot be told in one fucking night of theater. It's got to be a cycle of nine plays. And what wonderful permission he gave himself to do that, you know. And so sometimes when I come and someone asks, hey, what brings you to San Francisco today? I was like, this, Amy, you know. These folks, where's Amy?
You just
I'm exposing my heart. Make her watch the video.
She's in the other room watching you right now.
But I think that isolation that I speak of is why I was willing, gratefully, to come here today to share, you know, as Kenan says, this community, you know, because as I see my work grow and anxious to get back with the Culture Clash boys, we talk about hanging up our red noses for a little while, and Herbert's on a path and Ricky's on a path, and we'll come back together for that 30-year mark, because we've just promised each other there's some pieces that we have to hit before we sunset, before we let it go. We've made a promise to look at Jose Antonio Borciaga's work and talk about the early years of Chicano art, very much like in a Mark Rothko kind of way. Hmm. The progressive Jewish artists were doing very much, very similar to the arguments and the philosophical differences in the Chicano world. When Water and Power became a film based on the play, which I was lucky enough to direct, and it's finally ready, I realized that what was happening in my film was, yes, a specific East LA Chicano story endeavoring to reach for universal themes. And I realized then that in my specificity was my universal. And so every frickin' film, Latino film conference I go to, don't be Chicano, they tell you, filmmakers, you know, don't be specific, don't box yourself. You know what, you should be so lucky to get boxed. At least for one time, you know, you'll have a gig being boxed. And I realized that my composer, Ginger Shankar, the granddaughter of Ravi Shankar, first cousin of Nora Jones, I'm not just name dropping, but, you know, Ravi passed away during our final sound mix, you know, and Ginger was devastated, and we met at the Sundance Labs, and so the best tabla players in the world came to send Ravi off. She gathered all the tabla players in our studio and recorded them for Water and Power. And I realized that those tabla drums, mixed with the Aztec drum that was already in the movie, with Rage Against the Machine, with Young Chicano and Chicana bands from East LA, that those drums were haunting the colonial ghosts of the urban continent. And that somehow the work felt elevated a little bit. So that it was political, yes, I was making a political statement about Hispanic corruption in a place like Los Angeles. The deeper elixir, the deeper stuff that shakes me every time I see that movie is just that. This the colonial ghosts that are alive and well in the prisons. And that youth detention institutions, the you know, the Dow Jones line that's, you know, the prison industry complex, the privatization of prisons, the money that's made, schools, education. So my work will always be rooted in the political. And like Joan, I believe that the satirical allows that window of because, for example, the border is so polarized, and taking back the town hall that through a satirical piece like American Night, even though Sean San Jose found new depths for the central protagonist, that character deepened it, which is exactly what I wanted, and was able to find that with Mr. Moscone and a whole host of designers and folks. That train is going, the satirical train. You know, I don't want to get fucked with anymore in television, but there's new executives now that are like, okay, we're not going to mess with you. What do you want to do? I want to do a highly satirical news magazine set right on the border. And I want to go skeet shooting with Dick Cheney. And I want to sit down with Arpaio. And I want to get chased out of town hall meetings. I want to sit down with a cartel. I want to do all these things and find the executives and the people that allow us to do that. Because while Culture Clash is one of the book of plays that is banned and currently on a list by the Attorney General of Arizona, I find that in the television medium, Latino, we're the only ones not commenting on the border. John Stewart is. Steve Carell is. Colbert and Bill Maher are doing fantastic jobs. And perhaps because we don't have the access, but I find that, and even playwrights I talk to, they're and it's fine to be fanciful and you know, you want to write in a classical structure, that's great, but you know, people are dying in the Sonoran Desert on the American side. This year, the undocu-queer kids, to be undocumented and queer, these things are paramount, and we'll have to work and write in cycles to get at the bottom of it. And I'm re-energized every time, and I knew I'd be energized by coming here today, and sad not to see Rodessa Jones, but maybe she'll pop up, but to be with my peers and my teachers and the youngsters coming up is invigorating for a old war horse.
All right, so I don't want to give myself too much credit. I didn't choose to be political. I chose to be political. The year I was born, Sugar Hill Gang came out, Star Welfare, Reaganomics, Freeway Rick, so cocaine was being piped from L.A. to the Bay Area. And I grew up in this place in San Francisco called the Sunnydale Housing Project, which when I think of project, I think of experiments. So I realized at a young age I was being experimented on, and I didn't want to be a lab rat. And someone was telling me that this is a trap. From a very early age, I knew this is not cool, what this landscape is. I didn't know housing. Say, you know, you said in Detroit, Marvin Gaye was very prevalent in my psyche. Makes me want to holler. I didn't know how loud I'd be hollering, but at a certain point, I get a lot more bass in my tone about these issues. Growing up, you know, I got into acting in the fourth grade. I was literally a gravitational pull poured me toward acting. It wasn't nothing of my own doing, so I give myself no credit on that. 15, I became the first student ever on the San Francisco Board of Education. I thought I was gonna be some little stupid kid on there, just, oh yeah, you know, yeah, that'd be cool. You can cut all the funding for us, that's great. And I wasn't gonna say anything, cause hell, straight up. Like, no, I ain't gonna be a little whipping boy up here. And then I figured at 18, wow, if I was to ever write a book, it would not be either or, it'd be and both, because they both came together like the best peanut butter and jelly sandwich the world could ever offer me. I didn't realize that I had to isolate my passions about what was going on in my neighborhood and other people's neighborhood versus direct action. And so also with being chosen to be quote unquote political, there's a certain point where I'm at now, it's like, I want to heal people from political wounds. Because I feel you can be political all you want to say it, but at the end of the day, there needs to be some Neosporin up in your spirit. For real. Someone got to help either take the top off or cut off a little part so you can squirt it in. But at some point, there needs to be some healing from this. And so that's where I'm at now. And at 18, I met at Bravo, which again has some of the best just assassins come up in here and teach me. One of them was Ellen Sebastian Chang. She said straight up, Hob, she said, are you willing to die for what you have to say? I said, well, I'm willing to die in the past for what I had. I might as well, right? I might as well take a stance for what is being spewed out of me. So I said, fine, yeah, that's all right. And so my theater company came right before Bush stole the election, so there's already a pretty good, like, strike, right? I had all my great material for 10 years coming to me. Straight up. And so I remember, it's 2003 at Union Square, 20,000 people in Union Square. And so they asked me and my crew to come up and perform. I'm like, yeah, we're gonna rock this 20,000. I get up on stage, and at the Macy's building, I'm looking up, I see three snipers with their guns pointed at me. And I was like, well, the first time I had a gun pointed at me, but from that range and that high power, I was like, these guys didn't even gotta sneeze. And it was at that point where I looked at them, and I said, bring it. At that point, I realized not only am I willing to die for what I have to say, but I'm willing to die for the people I need to say it to, straight up. So, and theater was just a platform. You know, they said that a stage is to entertain and a platform is to influence. I felt like, all right, well, let's raise the stage up then. Let's make it both, you know what I mean? Like, let's use it to influence people. And actually, that was okay, you know, performing, you know, with the snipers. I mean, I remember Ellen used to send us to go perform at dope spots when people were selling drugs. Get their attention. They got guns, too. And they'll be a lot less, timid about you interfering in their process. But I remember we would go there on third of Paloo. We just spit, just on our heart, convincingly. And I remember transactions would just start going slower. Pretty soon, they start going like this. Pretty soon, the body language went like this. And pretty soon after that, it's like, we performing that next? And right there, I realized, that's a gust of wow. 21st century. Let's go, you know what I mean? Like, for me, Jesus' demographic, though, the downtrodden, the pimps, the prostitutes, that's for me. I thought I was called to go after. You said, political is love. Absolutely love. No one was coming to them, bringing theater to by the way, the same people I was trying to outreach to 40 years ago couldn't go see a theatrical play. Their great-grandparents said, no, you can't come in because of your tone. And so I said, you know what, man? I'm not waiting to bring the message to people. I'm bringing it to them, and then they'll come back. I'm going to be fishers of men and women and get them out of where they are and bring them to the stage, whether they're young, gangbangers, everybody. You know what I mean? Like, it totally hijacked my whole intent of just thinking, okay, I'm just going to perform. I'm going to express what I feel, and I'm going to go home. No, that doesn't happen when people start bringing you their gun clips after the show and say, you made me go legal tonight. Shoot, okay. Maybe I need to rethink this passion and the compassion, which is compassion mixed with action, equals political movement. And from that, developing relationships that has caused movements. Just one little seed planting caused political stirs throughout the Bay Area. People seeing a bunch of young kids in front of City Hall, in front of police stations, in front of places, mortuaries even, just performing. People are like, I want to do that. Where do you get this fearlessness from? Show me, because I want to be like that, because no one is coming where I'm saying and promoting a sense of fearlessness against this oppressive system. So hey, I'm very thankful and blessed to even be considered amongst the many who have been called to do this. I stand on the shoulders of great people, straight up. Last post too.
Make sure you tweet compaction.
Compaction plus action.
That's right.
Well, y'all are some amazing people. I'm so, everything that everybody has said about the work that you guys are doing is so inspiring to me. It means so much to me. I have a lot of questions. I feel like in my life, and in my life as whatever theater artist I might be, I have more questions than answers. The question that started this whole discussion about shouldn't I just go you know, get a nursing degree and go with, you know, Doctors Without Borders and go do some work, some real work or whatever that is. I still struggle with that. I still struggle with the use of what I do. And I have a lot of questions about it. I think, I mean, just little things jumping out, what you were saying about the love and what you were saying about being able to see those kids that are often the ones that need the most. There is something about that the love surrounding everything and this desperate need that people have to see and be seen, and the power of that, the power of visibility. That idea was kind of at the heart of what drove the writing of the play that I have here at the festival. Which again, I don't really know if I can call myself a political writer, because I don't think I start from a place of consciously trying to agitate change with what I do. It comes more for me from a personal place of not being able to sleep on this. You know, that it's something that I have in my life because of where I grew up as a child. I grew up in Idaho and was very, most of the time, the only Asian. So your experience at the camp being the only one is very familiar to me. And the sense of being somewhat invisible, and there being large parts of my identity that were invisible for everybody and for me for a good portion of my life. And the sense of needing to reclaim that and make it visible in some way. Has to do with what motivates my work. And for now, that's kind of enough to keep me going. I'm not sure exactly what's going to happen with that as things progress. But it is, especially with this play that I have here, it was about something happening that I could see because I was Googling and researching and trying to find news of it, and it was nowhere. And I thought, this is invisible right now. This family's loss, their grief, everything they're going through is invisible, and it's going to just disappear. And it was one of those things that just stuck in my gut, and I couldn't turn away. So, thank you all.
What that does is it makes the viewer feel like, oh, well, whatever is going on for me that doesn't fit the picture that keeps being told over and over again, I guess that makes me a freak or a weirdo or the fringe or not important or something, right? And so, but when you see someone coming and just bringing themselves fully, all of it, into the picture, all of a sudden it's like, oh, that's right. Mm-hmm. That is true, or that is true for me, or it gives somebody else permission to do that, and all of a sudden, the status quo is upset, right? Because that's so powerful. There isn't anything more powerful than someone who was completely willing to die for what they have to say, and to just stand on, this is me, this is who I am, this is my experience, and I'm not afraid of you being
what? I'm not afraid of you being afraid.
Right. So that's huge. That's hugely powerful to do that, the act of doing that. So you guys, one of the things that we were wondering about is, because Kimber, you were talking about what the impulse, because that's always what's really fascinating. What is the spark? Where is the impulse to act, to make something, to create, even when it's really hard to do, even when there isn't funding to do it, even when you have twins, somebody said, you know, and you just do it anyway. Because what? So what is the impact that you are after when you're creating the work or doing the work? And I'm also wondering about, who are you picturing? So if you're a writer, say, you know, do you, the person, the reader, or the audience member, or whatever, are there people that you're picturing that you're speaking to? I'm just curious about that too. But could you talk a little bit about the impact that you're after when you're hit with your creative spark?
I'm first. Itching, sitting on the edge of my seat the whole time. First, I want to say, I wish I got the first question.
You can answer that.
Yeah,
you can answer
that. I probably will inadvertently. Yeah, just sitting on the edge of my seat, enjoying what I was hearing, feeling extremely humbled by being in the room, and barraged with a series of questions, and I feel inept actually to answer the question around what I intend for my impact to be, because quite frankly, I think I still vacillate between wanting to make an impact and knowing where that impact will land. The theater is probably one of the most safe places to be yourself and stand on who you are and who you think you are in the moment. And for the people that I want to impact, they're not in the room. That's not the audience that 80% of the time I'm in front of. I'm in front of a bunch of people I don't recognize, a bunch of people who don't necessarily identify with me, or more importantly, who I don't identify with. The space where I really know the people that I envision speaking to, the space where what they're watching, what they're listening to, is extremely commercial. It's not $30 tickets. It's not. It's accessible because it's convenient on TV, on the radio. And I say that with total assurance because I work with that population, because I am that population, maybe aging out of it a little bit, but still a part of a population of young African-American people finding their identity very much broadcast to them through Viacom and Comcast and Clear Channel, and then saying, this is who I am. And having a really hard time, well into adulthood, challenging that view of themselves. And so, while I find absolute freedom to stand on who I am in the moment, and I say in the moment because I'm one of those people who still, I think, vacillates between an identity of who I think I am and what is pushed out to me on a regular basis, through those mediums, you know, this space is a free space to experiment and be who I think I want to be, and also not a space where I see folks who look like me who can benefit from that expression on a regular basis, on as frequent a basis as, you know, when they hop in the car and they turn on the radio and it's bitch home, et cetera, et cetera. Papa Molly, go to a party, drop your ass. Or when they go home and flip on the television, and whether it's BET or ABC, you know, seeing representations that are so dichotomous, so polarized. You know, there's Olivia Pope, you know, and then there's the video ho, and there's nobody in between. And the frequency of that messaging makes it difficult, I think, for some of us who might feel a little bit different to find ourselves in the middle. And so the impact question, I think, you know, when I think of my audience, and I think part of the reason why I'm doing hip hop, one of the larger reasons why I'm doing hip hop is because my audience listens to hip hop. My audience is attuned to the radio. My audience is watching television. My audience, unfortunately, is not in the theater where the freedom to be and experiment with who you be is. And so, yeah, so the audience that I envision, they're glued to the tube.
Could I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Just having heard that, you started by saying that you think maybe 80% of the time that you're maybe not in front of the audience that you really want to
In theater.
So I hope it's clear, like I asked this with deep respect and curiosity. What keeps you doing that 80% of the time instead of putting that energy into being with the audience you want
to
be with?
Because I get to find me here. And then I get to cultivate me here. And then I get to go back out and give it to the world, the audience that I'd like to be in front of. And I come back. It's a totally selfish experience, theater, for me. I'm not really concerned with the audience because I know the audience isn't necessarily for me most of the time. And when it is for me, oh my God, what a day. You know, what an opportunity to act and be. But most of the time, you know, it's an entirely selfish experience to identify those parts of me, hone them, cultivate them, and reserve them for the moment when I get to get out on a stage where I know there'll be, you know, 80 black kids, or, you know, Latino kids, or girls, you know. That's why.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, you can go.
Are you sure?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, okay. Everybody's so excited to have stuff to say. I'm so excited to hear everything everyone's saying, and I wish I'd gotten the last question too, because it was so nice to hear so many things I can relate to. So I think the impact, I think we're all hoping for, if I could be so bold to say, in different ways, is to put a face to and a voice to you know, human quality to people that are outside of the status quo, and not in a separatist way, but so that people who are in the status quo can see that and say, oh, I can relate to that. Maybe we're not so different after all. And I think that's the impact I'm really hoping for. And I've wondered a lot, what, you know, are we preaching to the choir doing theater? What is it really going to do in the bigger picture? And honestly, I feel, I mean, there's nothing like live theater and the live interaction and all that, but I don't know what else I can do very well. So I believe in the Teddy Roosevelt quote, do what you can with what you have where you are. And I feel like if this is what I can do well, or as well as I can, at the, you know, with the budget I have, even if it's small, with the people I have, at least I'm doing something. And I feel like I can't, you know, as long as things are so unequal, I can't just sit by and do nothing. So it's either do nothing or do what I can do in the way that I can do it. I feel like, is it all right if I address the political question just briefly? Because I've been thinking about that a lot too. And I think that I've always been a little confused by the negative connotation of being political. And perhaps it's my background. My dad was a California State Assemblyman for 12 years. And I really admired him and grew up with, you know, his closest friends and colleagues at the time were the most amazing people I know. Barbara Lee, Jackie Speer, Cruz Bustamante was his chief of staff. So growing up, I was thinking, what's wrong with political? The most awesome people I know are political, and I want to be so much like them. And so I sort of feel like if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And you're either political or you're apathetic and or indifferent. And so I feel like I kind of want to take back political, maybe in the same way I want to take back the word feminism and say that they're not bad words, they're empowering. And I just want to say to everybody here how inspired I am. And I think what I'm hearing from everybody that I can relate to is this feeling of, you know, being told that as a child that you can do anything, and then growing up and realizing that's not true, and maybe somehow I was born into the wrong body. And I think what we're all fighting for on some level is being able to have, you know, give everybody the freedom or even the basic human right to bring 100% of ourselves to the table as we are and have that be valued and have it not be the wrong body, you know? And I think I ask myself, why do this? It's so hard. And I feel like I can't, I'm getting emotional, but I can't live my life and not at least try to change. And it won't happen in my generation, but at least I can say I tried so that maybe generations after me, it will be different. And I think that's what we're all trying to do on some level. And I just really respect and admire everybody else in this room for doing that. That's all I got to say.
I guess what I was about to say was, because again, I guess I might be the odd person out in a rhetorical way. Was it hot? You're odd? Okay. Because when you have me, I'm not. And you're good. I did say, and I still say, that I am not quote unquote directly political, but I'm hoping my individualism adds to a collective. Because my individual, you hear what I'm saying? Experience has been a lot of the time, not always, a lot of the time, adhering to a group at the expense of who I am, no matter what that group was. For instance, in terms, like I said, in terms of writing the play Yellow Men, there were a lot of people who were supportive, there were a lot of people who were not supportive. I had certain black people say, why are you airing our dirty laundry? Mm-hmm. Having said that also, again, like I said before, I had certain white people say, we didn't know you guys, you people did that. So when one thing that's really important, I think, within all of this, lack of integration means retrogression. Retrogression means extinction. When Richard was talking about having Ravi Shankar's child and also dealing, say, with August, August came up with the whole idea of the canon via Eugene O'Neill. I was a little black girl between Central Harlem and El Barrio, sitting, watching Long Day's Journey into Night, going, here is this turn-of-the-century Irishman talking about drug addiction and alcoholism, and it's right in my house and outside the room, and outside, which was now then Mount Morris Park, which is now Marcus Garvey Park. August wrote that cycle because he was influenced by Eugene O'Neill. Eugene O'Neill could write something saying, like, all God's children got wings, and the Emperor Jones, because he studied jazz, and he also studied African history. When Eugene O'Neill did the Hairy Ape, the use of masks, the literal translation of mask means persona. He studied Japanese theater, and in that theater, mask persona. The person, when they feels the character come, that's when they reach for the mask and they put it on their faces. The mask has to speak to them. That also extends itself into the theater of the Aztec. It also extends itself to the theater of the African. So my experiences theatrically in certain ways have been kind of very similar, but in other ways. As black and female, you have to write a certain way. You have to write for the group. And I'm saying, I need to speak to people, not for people. This little girl who was in that room watching Eugene O'Neill totally understood because he spoke to me. He didn't try to speak for me. When you see a play, say like what Zaki was doing with For Colored Girls, many people responded to that. August's work, many people respond because they are storytellers. Beginning, middle, end, story, conflict, resolution, and having the language and a fertile imagination, and using the fact that it is diverse and the lack of diversity will cause extinction is the thing that's at hand. So again, like I said early on, I mean, I might be listening to the Mavericks, I might be reading, you know, one of my boys, Willie Perdomo, because there's I'm one of the New York Reading poets as well. And he and I have talked about this, and he said, you know, everybody wants Boricua, Boricua, and he says, you know, one of my favorite books, Dale, is Paris Spleen. I said, people need to see that a Latin writer can also, it's not mutually exclusive for you to love Baudelaire, for you to love Paris. So the expectation for me is to write a certain way. I wrote a play about an Irish family, and people will look at me like I'm out of my mind. I said, but white people have written about people of color. So, you know, what's up with that? And also, you know, so again, it's like it has to be diverse. In New York, I mean, I still live in New York, you know, and around the country, what's happened is this, is people said, how many black plays have we had? How many Latin plays have we had? How many Asian plays have we had? Opposed to how many good plays have we had? And with that becomes the institutionalized bias to write a certain way. And unfortunately, what happens with certain groups, again, not everyone, is that people take on the very bias that's been done onto them and they perpetuate it. And that's the legacy of what happens with race and bias. Oh, you're not black if you like this. Oh, you're not Latin if you like this. You're not Asian if you like this. You have to write this. You have to rep us. When I did Black and Blue Boys last year, because like I said, it's about all men that have been abused. And someone said, well, why did you write that? I said, well, first of all, I mean, again, maybe I am political, I don't know. I said, but people don't look at men as being abused, they look at them as abusers. And I said, we don't have a place for men to talk about their feelings and what's happened with them. And like I said, I wrote it where it can be done with men, women, anybody of any age, race, gender, whatever it is, because it happens to all people. And it's one of the people, one of the molesters, in fact, is a woman, because we're just beginning to really look at women as being molested, because there's something hypocritical that happens. You know, when you have an older man, say, and a young girl, we call that molestation. But if you have an older woman and a young boy, that gets called initiation. It becomes a rite of passage. So one woman said, she said, Dale, are you a feminist? I said, excuse my language for those of you who are delicate of eye and ear. I said, don't fuck with me. I said, I'm a humanist, and that includes feminism. I said, what you're talking about is convenient feminism. I said, because there are bad female people, right? So again, and there was another guy who said to me, he says, Dale, we're a white upper middle class audience. This is in Berkeley. And I said, again, do not fuck with me. I said, because I see where this is going. You're saying that only people of color or poor people or what have you do this. I said, this is universal. I said, you know, I'm playing men of every spectrum, from every socioeconomic group. So again, this is what my problem, or not problem, but some of the stuff that I've dealt with in terms of group, and again, not every group does that, but I kind of like have to be the individual in a weird sort of a way, if that makes any sense, and I'm sorry if I sound preachy.
Preach?
No, man.
Mr. Ryan and Steinbeck inspired many Chicano.
Of course.
And you're talking about our skill set, not being outpaced by our political ambitions, and I really appreciate that. We have to be good writers.
Irish drama, totally
inspired Lindbergh. Mm-hmm. Irish drama,
Juno,
yeah.
And
Pecop. Oh my gosh.
That's
the
Black family.
Yeah.
Right
there, you know? Yeah.
Sure.
Sure.
Political.
Mm-hmm. You done? Exactly. Yeah, no, well, just what I came, I was thinking of a phrase that, you know, Rafe Fine's mother was a wonderful writer called Jennifer Lash, and she was talking about the arts, right? And she came up with this thing that I wish I wrote. She said, artists like the saints are the receivers. Their job is to summon every emotion, every skill, to remain skinlessly alert in order to, as Picasso says, continuously find.
So I want to speak to the question of intention. And I'll speak from the point of view as a director. So when I was younger, I was really troubled by the fact that all the examples of directing that I had around me involved vision with a big leap. As a director, you're supposed to have this vision, this incredible artistic vision that you sort of impose on other people, and they would manifest for you. And that never worked for me. And so I love plays, and I love artists, and I love being with people and collaborating, but I never had a vision. And I figured, well, sooner or later someone's going to find out and they're going to kick me out. But I persisted. Even though I had no vision, I persisted and I studied and I worked. And, but then I realized, and it took me a long time to figure it out, that actually intention is much more powerful. And so I can think of three projects in particular in my life where I've had this very particular intention, and the project unfolded exactly the way that I imagined it, which is really strange, because that never happens in art, but especially in theater, because there's so many factors. And I won't tell you a lot about all of them, but one was something called the 911 Project, which we produced in San Francisco, December 2001. And it came out of a group that was meeting to talk about art. And we had a meeting the Friday after September 11th, and you know, we were going to talk about auditioning or something, and we didn't. And then, sort of spontaneously, people said, you know, we need to do something, we need to make something, we're so upset, what do we do, what do we do? And so some of us got together and we created this sort of cabaret that we performed at the exit, and we collected money for the global, the global exchange. And we just set out this call, we're like, who wants to make art? Who needs to do this? And we got about 50 people who were involved. And so there was a dance piece, and there were some people who wrote plays, and a bunch of people directed and coordinated. And if you ever been to the exit theater, we packed into the stage left dressing room, and it was like 150 degrees in there. And it was largely for the artists. People came, and we made some money, and we gave it away. But it was mostly for the artists, because people needed to do something. They needed a space to come together. So that was the first experience I had where having this clear intention of, we need to create a space where we can process what's happened, and we can tell the stories that we know, all the pieces of the stories, you know, everybody had stories, right? And then the second project happened at USF my first year. I was working with seniors who were getting ready to graduate. They were doing this really fancy class called Company, where they were supposed to make a full-length work about a social justice issue after a community residency, and they were supposed to do all the work themselves and self-produce. And it's a great idea, but it was a disaster. And they were incredibly angry, and this was my first semester as a teacher, and they were just like setting the building on fire. They were so pissed off. And I was like trying to shepherd them along and trying to like make the best of it. And then as I talked to them, I found out that one of the reasons they were so pissed off is that most of them had not been on stage in the 4 years they'd been in the program. And for different students, it was for different reasons. There was a lot of gender complaint. Like, we did both parts of Angels in America, there's only one female role. And some of them hadn't been on stage because of the way they look. Well, that was their perception, their body type or their ethnicity, and kept them off stage. And so I'm sort of listening to how upset these students are and how unprepared they feel to take on this big task. And I thought, well, this has to change. We have to get these students on stage. And if I can't find a play where I can put all the students I have in it, then I have to make one. So I wound up devising a piece. And Ashley Smiley was his new teacher. It was called Dust, a play about the Eve and all of us. It had an ensemble of 12. And it was about, we took Eve, the figure of Eve, through this journey. It was crazy, it was wild. We tore the set down in the middle of the show. And it was amazing. And so all these student artists who had not been on stage before, you know, one was Filipino, one was African American, one was Spanish, actually a transfer student. She got to speak in Spanish because she didn't have proficient English skills. So we had this really amazing mix of students on stage. It was an amazing piece. And the audience came up like, wow, that was awesome. Like, wow. I was like, okay. And it turned out exactly the way I thought it would, even though it was a devised piece, you know. So it was two. And then the third one was 2 years ago. I directed and produced a local playwright, Elizabeth Yelton's production of Hunter's Point, which is a play about homelessness and mental illness. Two sisters, one of whom is homeless, living on the streets in San Francisco. And she wrote this play, and we shopped it around, and nobody picked it up. I thought it was an amazing play. We did a reading in front of a group of folks for the National Association of Mental Health, and they were beating the doors down. I thought, yes, this is our experience, but nobody wanted to produce it. So we said, okay, we'll do it ourselves. But if we're going to do it ourselves, and we're going to do all of that work, then we may as well find the audience who really needs to hear this play. And so we started looking for community space and community partners, and that was a really long journey. If I had known what I was getting into, I might have given up. But we wound up performing the play in an actual theater in the basement of St. Boniface Church in the Tenderloin neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And we performed it as a benefit for the Gubbio Project, which is a nonprofit that operates the church as a homeless shelter. And we did a professional quality production with professional design, professional actors. And we spent 3 months going around the neighborhood and making connections and building community contacts. And 800 people came and saw the play. And we know from our amazing audience responses that 75% of people in the room reported an experience with mental illness, and 48% reported an experience with homelessness. So part of the vision of that project was to bring, and we also had traditional theater goers, part of the vision was to bring this mixed audience together to experience the play, and particularly to bring people who sit on the receiving side of social services and the people who deliver them, bring them together to have an experience in the play. And that happened, despite, you know, just sort of being a ridiculous thing to try to do. So those are my three experiences of intention. And the power of intention as an artist, and how, even if you don't know how you'll do it, or you know, where you're gonna get the resources, that if you hold the intention of what you're trying to do, of a group of people you're trying to bring together, the experience you're trying to create, that that can get you amazing places.
Thank you.
Inspired by what has gone on so far. I'm going to try and say them in some order. They may come out of order, but hopefully they will in some way speak to intention and art. When Amy invited me to be on this panel, I was like, and I looked at the rest of the people on the panel, I said, why would you ask me to be on this panel? And I think that I'm realizing, listening to everybody, that the reason is because I am in the process of shifting how I work, and so I actually needed to be on this panel, listening to everybody's stories. And I would say that I come from what we call traditional theater background, and I know everyone has a different version of that, but my version of that is you write something in your solitude and your poverty, and then you send it out, and people you don't know read it, and if they like it, or if it fits a mission, or if it's got few enough actors to produce, they will bring you in for either a workshop, a reading, or a production. And in that system, and I don't want to denigrate that system because I think it has a place, but in that, within that system, it doesn't feel like the process starts until you get in the rehearsal room. And that is sort of where it feels like a process starts. And yet there's all this time spent researching and talking, you know, that is also. So I will tell you what has happened for me recently with intention. I know that the recent shift has been that I now want my plays to feel like an invitation and not a presentation. Mm-hmm. And that I want the process of getting there, wherever there is, to be as impactful and as important to me and the people I'm talking to as the performance or whatever the opening night or closing night or are, sometimes the same night. I want those two things to be equally important, and if one has to be more important, I want the process of creating it to be more important. And by important, I mean to reach more people or to teach me more about the world. And I think the reason that happened, and it's a personal reason, but this thing that you just said at the beginning, this quote that I'm putting on my wall now, of my mother told me I could be anything I wanted to be, and so therefore that was true. I really don't like separating my writing from teaching, because I think that I actually for a long time would have said my political work is my teaching. But what started to happen to me in teaching is that I started realizing that either I was working with students who didn't have that parent, and the goal was to figure out how you can get them to be seen, how you can learn from them, which in turn enriched my writing, but also helped them find a way to a voice. Or you were working for people who did have that parent, but something in the world told them something else, between the time the parent got to them and the time they got to me. And the second thing that happened was that I started imagining having a family of my own. So all of the things that I originally was interested in, and I'm not denigrating my old work, but I was definitely the one of the fanciful writers. I was like, a ghost story, bring it on, gothic, I love a vampire. Okay, I'll do that. All of those were done in law. I was writing those a lot for the whimsical nature of it. And when I started considering having kids in this world, the stories that I was drawn to, I mean, the world started to terrify. And the news suddenly became ominous, and the questions started to pile on. And so what I have recently started doing is trying to figure out how anything I attach myself to will, in the process of creating it, instill some kind of a conversation that where we all get riled up about the same thing, and also comforts me so that I don't feel like I'm alone in being terrified about the world I would bring children into. And the other thing I will say about audience is that I was lucky enough to study with Paula Vogel, who is one of the greatest women I know and the greatest educators. And she always used to say, you need to write the piece for one person you love very, very much. You need to start from a place of very specific love. And I still buy into that, but I think my new view is, and what I'm trying to do now, is to find more and more people to love. I am writing for one very specific person, but I'm also writing for a group of individuals that I know well enough that I feel like I can love specifically. So that is how our audience view has sort of changed and depends on the story. But I would just love to thank everyone for everything you've said thus far and what you're about to say. You haven't spoken yet. And thanks to Amy for forcing me to be on the panel, because it is certainly influencing where I'm at right now.
I'll go.
Hopefully this won't be too long-winded.
So the question of trying to have an impact on the audience also has to do, for me, with, as it has with a lot of people, with why you started. I come from a political family. I was taken to every anti-war protest. You know, I was born outside of Detroit, but I grew up outside of Watts. And so I remember the tanks coming down the streets. I remember at one point my mother, us being at a big anti-war protest, and my parents are dragging us through this parking lot, running as fast as we can, me and my two sisters and our pet rabbit, and we're all dragged through. We had the rabbit to prove that we were peaceful. And the thing has turned into this monstrous riot. And at one point my mother pointed at this white line. I'm like, why are we running? And she points at this white line in the distance in the night. She says, see those? Those are police hounds chasing us. So that was my childhood. And I was like, this is what you do. You try to change the world. Because whatever you're doing, that's the purpose. That's the purpose of life. And while being reasonably histrionic, I wasn't thinking of myself as a theater person until I went to see Hair, the original musical Hair. By that time, I moved to San Francisco, and there's a point in Hair, if you've never seen it, I don't know if they do it in modern productions.
Michael, is this going to be about nudity?
No. It is not about nudity.
Just wondering.
I know, but under all this. There's a point at the end of Act One, and this is after having been taken to all these protests and knowing, you know, cops, shields down, run. The point at the end of Act One, where they're in the middle of making these incredibly political statements about dodging the draft and the war, and suddenly in the Orpheum Theater, the doors at the back of the both aisles are kicked in, and all of these cops come streaming down the aisles in full riot gear, you know, screaming, and they get up on stage and they're clubbing the cast. And then they turn to the audience and pose, end of Act One. And it was so perfect, because it was terrifying, but it was the world that I knew. And I was like, that's what theater can do. The outside world came streaming in to the theater and meshed so perfectly. And you could see the whole audience just was like, are we committing a crime by being here? You know? That feeling of being wrong. So I got exposed to that. I had a chance to see how much you can affect an audience, you know. So what I try to do when I'm writing stuff and when I teach, because I do teach, and I always set the goal for the audience, for my students. They're teaching, you teach admission as a guest teacher. And I always tell them first day, the purpose of every play is to change the whole world. Anything short of that is masturbation. If everybody in the world sees your play and understands it, everything changes. Oh, yeah. And they would write beautiful and amazing stuff, really. Like you were saying, you know. They're writing stuff, and the teachers and the grown-ups were like, I had no idea about the pressure that they're under and their vision of how the world can be and how the world should change and their sense of horror that they have of the world that we, as the grown-ups, have created and the pressure upon them to change it, to save it from us. Was brilliant and amazing. And so I try to bring that, sorry, I'll calm down. I don't drink coffee, by the way. That passion is what I try to bring to the stuff that I write, to impact the audience, to challenge them, and it depends on the audience. And that's a big thing. Depends on not just the audience, but the show. The stuff I've written for the Mime Troupe is to try to, people say, you know, the audience, you're preaching to the converted. First of all, no. You're challenging this audience. All audiences for theater are self-selecting. It's not up to you who shows up. But what you can do is try to challenge the people who did show up. They shouldn't be made to feel comfortable. You know, they've got all of their, oh, this is the way the world is, this is the way the cast is going to be. Make me feel good about being part of the solution. Fuck no. You know, as far as I'm concerned, did you drive here? You're part of the problem. You know, just that simple. You start your car, you're making the world a worse place. There's no argument against that. So, you have to accept your responsibility as an audience member, even in a show that you went to see because it's going to speak to you in some positive way. You're still, at some level, are you part of the problem or not? And my job for Mind Trip shows is to give the audience ammunition for the arguments for social justice, for economic justice, you know, for feminism, for anti-racism, for anti-colonialism, and to challenge them at the same time. And also, and another thing with political theater, and again, all theater is political, you're either upholding the status quo or challenging it. Another thing is, that's really important, even if somebody is always telling you, you're just preaching to the converted. The ideas that we're presenting are so radical, not just the Mind Trip, but all of us, are so radical and different that it is important for the audience as a community to not feel alone, to not feel isolated. They sit home and they're watching television and they're going, oh, this is the way that all women are, this is the way that blacks are, this is the way that Latinos are, or whatever, and that's the message that's coming at them. And they're like, that's all bullshit. They're by themselves. But when they're sitting in a theater, or even in a movie, if they're sitting there and they're seeing something that's completely different, they are validated in their revolutionary thought by the community of the audience. And that is something that we cannot devalue by constantly telling each other or ourselves, we've got to reach a new audience. It is important to reach a new audience. But at the same time, we should not devalue the people who showed up to be part of a movement. Also, the stuff I did not for the Mime Troupe, like you were talking, as you were mentioning, that to not segregate ourselves as creators. So when I did the stage adaptation for 1984, one of the best things every time was walking into that room when they go, and here's the writer, Michael Gene Sullivan. And I come in, and they're not expecting a black guy. They're just fucking not, you know? And so it's so nice to be able to come in and shake that. You know, and then I start talking about corporatization and all this stuff, and they're just like, ah, fuck, please. But to have that, this is a work that speaks to anyone. When the play was published recently, and I put in there, you know, change the cussing, not cussing the play. Change this stuff because I want the show to be done around the world, but I always want it to be local. You know, if it takes place in this, it's not set in London like the book is. It's set wherever it's taking place. Because it is your play, it is your nation, your culture, your race, whatever, your group's comment about totalitarianism. And so, the fact that as a black writer, that was that play that I wrote because it speaks to me and my experience growing up in a police state, as I do, and to try to help other people see that. Right after that particular show, that particular show has five guys and one woman in it. The next show I wrote is five women. which actually is going to open next October in Berkeley. Yeah. And so because, you know, I didn't want to feel, I felt like, for one thing, you know, the idea of what's the spark, why do you write something? I wrote that play because I felt bad about writing a play with so many men. So I wrote a play for older women. There's one woman in her 40s, and the rest of them are in their 50s to 80s. Nice. And it's a group of leftist women, and it's a farce. And the other thing is, a lot of times you'll see plays about, you know, the old revolutionaries, and the whole play is about them questioning their politics. Did we make a mistake in the 60s? Fuck that, no. So this show is about validating them. They never question their politics. The drama is about something else. The dramatic story is about something else, you know? And their arguments about, it's fun, there's a joke in it that actually uses both Stalin and Trotsky in the punchline. And so, to say again, this is our, you know, we can own that experience. It's not most people who buy tickets for plays are women. Most subscriptions are bought by women. Most of the roles are for men. Most of the directors are men. Most of the playwrights who are accepted are men. I mean, I feel a little weird writing the all-woman play, and people keep saying you should submit it to these all-woman theaters. I'm like, I can't. Those slots are for women playwrights, you know? And it doesn't matter if my play's the best fucking thing in the world. I don't get to do that, you know? And I'm fine, you know? So then, the next play that I'm writing now has to do with the Runaway Slave Act. And it takes place, and it's about an actual uprising that happened in Pennsylvania. And it's about treason. There's an uprising against the act, with all of these slaves, and they were tried for treason because they were seen as taking up arms against this law is taking up arms against the Constitution, which is taking up arms against the country. So the play is about what we as blacks have had to go through and how difficult it is, even when we're standing up for our freedom, for not to be criminalized. In my mind, it's also about Occupy. It's also about any time you stand up for democracy and freedom and you're labeled a traitor. And people say, oh, we have a system, we have a way of working through this stuff. You can elect your officials, you can petition the government. Really? You know, that how that label is used now, however we as citizens try to address the grievances that we have, that it can be labeled as treason, is something. So I'm trying to blend these ideas into one play that hopefully the goal is always, you know, the whole change the world thing. But also, I'm almost done. I told you to be short. The other thing is, you really want to, change the audience so that after the show, they stream out of the doors and overthrow corporate capitalism. You know, you want to make them into activists. And that's what it is.
I think one of the great things about this panel is how much people are talking about life and their families and their neighborhoods. It's really inspiring, especially in the sort of box of the make-believe theater world. We spend so much time having the same lame conversations that aren't about the real reasons that everyone is doing it. So even if we pose the question, it's great. It's like a great reminder too, you know what I mean? And I think what's big and daunting about the questions too are like these, I don't know, there's like definitions and language and identity that dictate a lot of these things, like political things. Respect what you're saying, because my experience in watching you is it is political, obviously, that they feel it. But, you know, coming from your writing perspective, I imagine maybe that's different. And I think it's hard to own those three words, you know, like, what are the definitions that the world gives us? Who tells you what your identity is? How you self-identify? And then language is kind of the only thing that we have, right? I mean, even we all know that, and even the overseer knows that, wow, that language thing is really powerful. you know, and so that's a it's a good good reminder, and it's good to hear all the different languages around this in this room here. And just in terms of politics, it's really hard for my brain, I think, to go from the I think the main thing that I like about it is that we're just trying to use it. I agree, it's like just putting a human face. And I think everyone has said that to a certain degree. I mean, the thing about the world that's so crazy is that it swirls around us, and it really is really fucked up. And then you hear people, like I've heard your pieces, especially when you spit your solo pieces, that the world spins around you. Or anyone seen when Richard, and especially when he does his poems in the Culture Clash pieces, or if you've seen Jessica Hagedorn do her thing, or Roger Genver Smith, you get this sense that you're in the world, even though you're in the brain of that person speaking to this. You feel the world spinning around you. That's what I feel like a lot of times. And I think in terms of impact, it's really hard to say that I can make an impact, because the things that are really, really, if you know, you make me write it in a grant, usually when you have to do it, like, what's your shit about? the two reasons outside of that you would do it, you know, like, we're living through two epidemics in this world, you know, crack and AIDS. And I guess I think about it every day of my life. And I don't know what impact I could make, other than I have to respond to that, or you have to see it. Like, I think that we're, in some ways, in this communion world that we do with performance and language like this, we're just trying to witness it all. And in some ways, we're recording the thing, and, you know, history's gonna look back, especially like at the 1980s, and they're gonna be like, this is fucked, man. They fucked all these people. And then, like, how do you make an impact against that? And then, like, how do you make a piece that does that? You can't make bullets go backwards, if you can't clean blood, you know what I mean? But you can, I guess, get together in a room and you think about it. And like, who said, I think you said, you know, like, in three or four generations, maybe we'll know. Maybe I had an impact, because motherfuckers think about it now. We don't have a stupid president that is scared to say the words. Or we have a new way of defining what rehabilitation means. And so, can we do that? Yeah, I think we can do that. We're citizens of the world. We can, you know, you're right, man. We can change the world. It's like this, you know, because you have these crazy egos. It's like, for me, it's just like trying to surround myself and cling on to people that have these bigger ideas of it, which keeps my ego in check a little bit. But then, at the start of the day, you still have to have that big ego to be like, yeah, I'm gonna make a change. But the change for me, a lot of times, is just in response. Like, how many times can you? I don't know. What do you guys do with death? You know what I mean? Like, I have a really hard time with this, but I'm alive. You know what I mean? My grandmother did a lot to bring our family here, so shouldn't I honor that? You know what I mean? So it's a hard thing, the impact thing, but the need part of it is really great. You know what I mean? And I think, again, the power of language is such an amazing thing, you know, and how that helps us identify ourselves. Also, it's just like these definitions are so jive, they're so bogus, and you know what I mean? Like, theater, actor, writer, playwright, dramaturg, performance center. I mean, like, they're all outlets for our identifying the world and our neighbors and the people we sit next to, the people we... That's why I don't have to do graffiti, you know what I mean? I'm here. Not only I'm here, but my block is here. And I think we do that, you know, in other ways with language and with performance. And so I suppose the impact is that you get everybody in the world talking. I'm like Ryan, you know, like, I can't. My best friends come to a show? Huh? What's a show? Huh? A play? huh? And so, and does it mean that like what I'm not doing is valued or they're not interested or interesting? Nah, it doesn't mean that at all. I think we have this really messed up, not messed up, we just have a, we have a long way to go to make some of these systems work better, that's all. And I just, I like to be part of the machine that makes the membrane and the space between these definitions get closer and closer together. Like, I look at it like the block that I grew up on, or the neighborhood I grew up in. It was really, really tight. You know what I mean? It was, it's mashed up like that, and that's beautiful. That's like the most beautiful thing, you know, like your block. And I would like to make, I like the impact, I would like to make it just that it reflects back and forth. And I think whether we have to do it in these ways, I think that's to be questioned. I don't think, you know, I don't think this is the, maybe always the best way. Michael will speak in a minute, but to other ways that we can do that. Isn't like a plaza a really cool way to get down? Or, you know, isn't like around a dinner table a cool way to do it? Or on the lawn or something? So something about taking back our humanity in the world. And I think we feel that humanity a lot when we're on the corner. Like Swab said, you know, like when you're standing on the corner, you have to, you have, eventually, it's gonna push and it's gonna make a change. Eventually, if it don't make a change, I mean, let's not get too big on ourselves, you know. Is it gonna make a change? You know, like, I mean, people have died to make bigger change than the kind of change that I think that we're talking about on the table right now. So, can we do it? I don't know. But, you know, I wanna keep trying to do it. Because, man, you know, I live in, I'm a San Francisco native, and more than that, I'm just a person of the Bay. And like, just who took the cities from us? Like, who the fuck decided that they could have our neighborhoods? And who says that everywhere that you know that your mom worked and lived is suddenly a new spot and it's called something? Who decided all of that? And why aren't we part of that? And I think by talking about it, and you know, acting up and acting out about it, we take part in that argument against again too. And that's what I mean. It is a messed up world, and you know, stand up, put microphones on, put cameras on, and let us all hear it and speak it. It's just it's cool to be able to know how many of us are interested in that part of it, because it can be disheartening thinking that you're shouting the wind a little bit. You said, John, that you know you wrote the first joint to be like, I'm gonna shout against the thing, because that's what, that's part of the reason why you do it, right? That you feel you have the enough courage or enough whatever to be the person, like, are you not, you know, just gonna look at me and listen to what I have to say, because I'm gonna shout it because it's that important, because no one has heard it before, because that person's memory deserves to be served, because that person's name needs to be shouted out, because that city is our city, things like that. You know, I love that story you tell, Michael. Like, the story of your, that's the thing, the story of your child, that's the theater shit right there. That's the real shit. No, I would like to be part of more ones, hear more things that happen like that, to break down these walls like that.
Robert Bowen's Great Dress.
Say again, Richard.
I didn't interrupt you.
No, I wanted
to. It's a brother we lost in the last couple of weeks. A great actor. I just wanted to say his name.
Yeah.
Robert Bowen was great. That's a great performer. So sorry.
No. Actually, I was trying to figure out what the hell to say, and that really helps me. Because one of the things I thought that was worth saying was like the names of people not around the table.
Exactly.
Who are a part of the conversation. And who a lot of us stand on the shoulders of and stand in line with. And I know you mentioned Boal before. He was a friend and mentor of mine for years. And so I think about Mr. Boal and his relationship to this work. And I was just trying to think about, like, the questions in this work. Because I've really, it's amazing to get to listen to people talk about their experiences and to hear your stories and where you're at. And a lot of what people have shared is the, when we think about theater and plays, we think a lot about story. I'm slightly estranged from the idea of story being the center of what theater is and needs to be. I love story. I believe in story. I make shows that tell stories. I like going to the theater to hear stories. I also feel like we have been and can often be colonized by the notion that a singular narrative or even a collaged narrative can be the experience that might have the impact we want around certain things. And it gets to what Sean was just saying, and it takes me to Boal, just in this idea that personally, I have become, in the last batch of years at my company and on my own, I don't know, as interested or more interested in making spaces not where strangers come in the dark and watch something and leave, but where strangers come together and my job is to build an experience where strangers have to connect with each other publicly. Because I actually think that this is not instead of, this is in addition to. I think in addition to all the work we are talking to, it is really important that we are making spaces where what theater and the arts bring to public discourse is actually leveraged at the practice of democracy, which is terribly dysfunctional and practically non-existent in so many contexts. Where are the public spaces where we are with strangers and actually communicating and connecting and having, whether we want to call it dialogue or discourse or discussion or whatever, but where we're wrestling with stuff. And we do wrestle with things internally. When we watch them in front of us, we are asked to sort of be wrestling within ourselves, and then perhaps that spills out. But I don't think that's what we need as much as what we need is spaces where people who are not like to be together in space, right, and have an experience. That's what I'm personally interested in. And I think about people like Augusto Boal and the question that he was always asking of, so when we make work, especially in his, you know, he passed away about 5-6 years ago, in the latter years of his life, do we simplify through our art, or is what we're doing dealing with nuance? What's the role and intention of activist work? Is it to make a clear protagonist and antagonist, a hero and a villain, and make that obvious, which was how he started that work in the favelas in Rio, right? That's how he started. But that's not where he wound up decades later. And I think about somebody like Bob Alexander, great artist who nobody in this room, who's ever heard of Bob Alexander? Yeah, just like a couple people. One of the most important theater artists of like the second half of the 20th century. And the reason we don't know who he is because A, he didn't write anything. And B, because he spent his time on the other side of town from where Arena Stage is, creating the Living Stage, where he worked for decades with what he termed the forgotten people of Washington, D.C. He worked with single moms. He worked with folks in rehab. He worked with released folks out of incarcerated settings. He worked with any population that wasn't going to the theater. And his goal was, let's make creativity available. He wasn't just making plays for them, he was constantly making performance work with them in a space dedicated to their lives and that experience. And his question, especially towards the end, he passed about 6 or 7 years ago, maybe a little longer, was always, who do you choose to work with and for, and why? Who do you choose to work with and for, and why? And then I think about Ping Chong, who's another friend and mentor who does awesome work, who's been seen out here over the years. And Ping's got these two strands of work. Ping's got this history of like avant-garde, abstract stuff that he made for decades that's really beautiful and at times inaccessible, but still like super moving and beautiful. And then in the last 20 years, he starts creating this series called Undesirable Elements, which he's now done like 55 of them around the world, where he works mostly, originally with immigrant communities, in cities all over the world of people who are considered not welcome. And then he has started simply working with populations who are other, very publicly other in the communities. He interviews them, he researches with them, and then they perform their stories. Mm. He has created what we call a seated spoken word opera, where 7 community members who have never performed before generate their stories with him and a collaborator, and it was me some about 15 years ago. That gets turned into a 90-minute script, and they sit at microphones with a beautiful sort of aesthetic around them, and they perform the script that they have worked on with him of their life. And the question that he's always asking that I find fascinating is, who tells their own story, and what process are they invited into
to participate and reveal and share their own story. So I just kind of want to offer and add to the conversation that in addition to all the ways we're talking about gathering and sharing stories and making space for ourselves to be heard and making spaces to tell audiences what they need to hear, the act of listening and the act of being in relation to and the act of making work with, both in spaces that look or feel like this, but also in spaces that don't look or feel anything like this, and in practices that don't necessarily look like plays, and in events that aren't necessarily deemed like a traditional performance, but are performative, that involve imaginative acts and expressive actions, which is personally my own definition of theater, a time-based event that engages imaginative acts and expressive actions, which might happen here for you to watch, and might happen in the public square, and might happen in a classroom, and might happen elsewhere, and might happen over 3 days, and might happen in 2 hours. Like, are we stretching the boundaries of our form to work not just within the systems of distribution that we can have access to or break into, but also to engage around these issues and with our fellow community members in ways that are surprising and impactful through what happens, not just through what gets witnessed. So that's what I think about.
I think that's important. Actually, I'm glad you said all of that.
I'm
sure everybody is. That's exactly why I said in the very beginning that, you know, since we're talking theater in the traditional sense in this room, I'll say, you know, I'm doing theater. But, you know, I take in that vein theater everywhere I go. You know, I'm an athlete. I train people. It's theatrical, you know, in the sense that they're creating their experience. Most importantly, there's a spoken word event that I've been hosting for the last year or so, and it has been a traditional spoken word event for 7 years. But there's the audience, and there's the spoken word artists, and there's people who sign up on your list, and they're the people that come and listen. And there's never been public discourse. While the same time that these people are coming to listen, there are these world events going on. And so, as of late, ever since I came in, I'm not taking any credit except that I am very interested in the conversation. I'm very interested in the full creative aspect of everybody taking part in the conversation, everybody telling their story, everybody grappling with the world around them, not just coming to listen, not just coming to watch in the traditional sense of theater. And so, yeah.
Well, I mean, I even think, like, I want to, you know, there's, I think about American Night a little bit, which I didn't see here, but I saw at Oregon Shakespeare Festival, which I loved and thought was, like, a great show. And I saw it with, like, an audience that, like, you know, in a lot of ways couldn't be further from some of the experiences in the story than imaginable. And it was great to see that show with that audience. And that show, like, had such a life of spilling off the stage in a way that, you know, just because I have the particular interest that I have, I don't know you that well, Richard, we crossed paths a lot over the years. There's this part of me that's like, oh, I just want to go like in a room with Richard and play for a week and figure out like how that thing is this event that everybody in the room is a part of in addition to being a witness of. Because it's just got such a rich set of questions in it. And it just made, like, I did a lot of writing a couple days after that, which is great. It's usually a successful experience for me as an audience member. But then I wanted to, like, I don't know, like, get in there and, like, be a part of it in some way. And just get interested.
I've been thinking about that a lot too, actually, in terms of going into this century and all of the changes we've gone through so quickly with technology, and it seems people are more and more isolated and wired in. And
We're always here.
Yeah, and I've been thinking a lot, like, how is that shifting theater? And I'm wondering a lot whether people need more to connect in this day and age, and the idea that there's the audience and then the stage and the fourth wall is like an iron curtain and cross over. Maybe, you know, people say theater is dying, right? But maybe it just needs to change and evolve to fit what's going on with what people need now to feel connected and more part of a whole experience. And I know that's a whole separate panel and interesting discussion, but I've been thinking about it, a lot about it too.
It's exciting, and I'll shut up, but this one other thing that came up a lot was people talked about like audience. And sort of our audience is who our audience is, right? And the other thing that we're really passionate about is audience design at Sojourn, meaning like I'm not interested in making shows where I'm not a part of who's gonna, who I'm making it for. Like I am. That's not like what I'm interested in as an artist anymore. I still like sometimes like it's exciting to be in those spaces, but in general, I'm interested in making projects where the development of the work and the way that the host producer is engaging with the community is not just like we're gonna market and we'll see who comes and then we'll contextualize the work somehow so for this audience it's interesting. No, I actually want to be working to build audit and do. This is what we do. We put as much energy as I know you do.
I just want to say, how much of that is actually shaped by your perspective of what it takes to create change? Because I think about the companies here that have a long trajectory are definitely products of the 20th century, the long 20th century. We're talking 70 years of a type of what Gramsci would have referred to as a war of maneuver. Right now, what we're seeing in this day and age is the need to be able to engage deeply in a war of position, where we're entrenched. The political action was happening already in the streets for a period of 75 years. The theater was only reflecting what was happening, reinforcing that. Now, it's a different scenario. These practices, in terms of bringing people into the mix, inevitably are political acts in and of themselves.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And so is that part of your theory of what it takes to make change?
Yeah.
And so I say that's something that's happened for some of us, the companies that were born out of that popular theater movement, where you were already embracing and reflecting the beauty of human culture, to this particular moment where we actually need to gauge just in the process of being human once again.
With one another in time and space.
But I think it's not an either or kind of thing, and I think that's what can be, I think, in political theater, I mean, not to go into too much, but I think that danger of whatever one theater company is doing is the model. It's like different audiences, different situations, a show that might be really big in, New York and theater for a new audience is doing something that's, you know, here, or what Robert was doing in D.C. may not fly in someplace else. The different theater, communities and communities inside of communities. I was in Denver and I did this thing where all of us, this little wall thing, which probably wouldn't work in San Francisco, was I took a bunch of students and I had them have an argument. I divided them into fours. Two people had to have an argument about abortion on a bus.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, loud argument, and then they would get off the bus. The argument had to go on for 10 minutes, just improv-ing. They get off the bus, and then the two people who were still there had to go, isn't that interesting? And the conversations that happened on the bus. But I was doing it both to have the impact on the community, because it's Denver, a very conservative community, but also to let the actors know it's okay to talk about politics, because that's not what they were getting at school. They were like, this is the stuff you avoid. So, no, this is exactly what you want to talk about.
Also, when something is not a play, you know, we have to be real about that, too. And when it doesn't fit, you know, we just, we finished a film about Mission Hotel Fires based on Alejandro Murillo's short story. He's the poet laureate of San Francisco. The gentrification is moving so fast, so swiftly through the Mission, that I personally am not sure that I have a year to write a play about it. But last week we made a film about it. You know, get a crew, be nimble, go out there. And what do? We drag Sean into it, we drag Christopher Ward Wright into it, we drag Jeff Boyle into it, Mike Torres, and Donald Lacey. You know, and now, do it, now. That doesn't bode well for a theater panel, but it's taking exactly our teatro and our theater form and taking it right to cinema. Cinema is also a popular form. They know that in Havana. They know that in Mexico City. You know, it's only a very elite festival thing here, you know, in America. But I'm looking at when our theater goes on buses and on movie screens, not Hollywood, but in the cinema.
Yeah, real quick about Oshan. Theater changes, man. In New York last year, speaking of the Arena Post Cafe,
yeah,
we met a girl who, she's from Brooklyn, 18 years old, pregnant by, had three kids, all by her stepfather. Mother had been killed, brother been killed, shot to death in the same month. She's going to take her life. The same week we came to do the show with her, we came to the community center that she was at, did the show, and we didn't separate from her after that. like no one was coming into this place. It was called the Door in Manhattan.
Yeah.
No one was coming in doing theater live. I mean, we're this place is 5-6 stories, and we're right on the ground floor where all these kids are coming through, like 1,000 kids, just doing theater right there, hip hop theater. Let me just make that specific. And I'll be on that 1 second. We did that. You know what I mean? She said, I'm just going to take my life. Next thing you know, not only is she about to take her life, she you know, stayed alive, found out she had 3 cancerous tumors, gave my cast members power of attorney, not her grandma, not her cousin. She gave us power of attorney when she went under the scope if she didn't make it to pull the plug. Gave my cast members. Of course, she comes out cancer-free, removed.
Nice.
One of my cast members wound up adopting her. Right out here. One girl, now that girl's all over the world, you know, I mean, exceeding, you know, and I had to also just, when I was coming up, for this younger generation, who, by the way, is going to be quadruple threats in the arts, kids are at 5 years old, singing, dancing, acting, editing their own video, spoken word, and these kids don't even know that theater is, it's a family reunion with the arts, you know what I mean? Like, when I came in, God bless Sarah Mabry, she's from Boston, said, I asked her, can I bring hip hop into my theater? And she said the most profound thing, yes. Can I infuse different things? So now we're in a generation of filmmakers, and you know, for me, I like Chinese opera. I like ballet. I'm gonna incorporate that with everything I do. And that, to me, is a part of the outreach for the younger generation to be like, it's not just a standard old, you know, I'm gonna come up and do a monologue. I may just want to do some collage and beatbox and then come out to something. You know what I mean? Give the kids an opportunity to be creative. And next thing you know, from my experience doing this for 12 years, has created a generation of artists, multidisciplinary artists, who hasn't yet, don't even have a feel for them yet. These kids are about to explode onto the scene and, I believe, take over this kind of torment theater space that's not giving them the creative juices to go buck wild and then sprinkle them with some social consciousness to not only figure up what they already have innately, to just be seen and shown. I mean, these kids are doing stuff, I'm telling you, it's almost in diapers still. That's like, if the theater community, because I believe that all the other genres are great, but the disciplines inside of theater helps harness that energy even more. There's nothing like theater training. I've trained rappers, I've trained spoken word artists, and they become better in that field than they were before they started. And so to take the techniques we have and help build up other genres and say, okay, look, no more of this isolation stuff. Okay, you do your field over here, you do your field over here. Let's start morphing more. Let's start getting creative. Let's talk to these digital people down here in Silicon Valley. Let's get some technology in it too. Like, kids need to be entertained. They need to be edutained. But they need that entertainment aspect as well. And let them just go crazy. Like, if you want to talk about audience, that's what needs to be done.
Well, do you think also, I mean, this is like against, you know, how people keep themselves ignorant. For instance, like last year, you know, when I did Black and Blue Boys, right, there was a co-pro between here and Goodwin. There's only one theater in New York that was willing to do it. And the reviews, for, you know, were very good. But also, again, I have had, here we go, I've had theater people say, this makes me uncomfortable. This personally makes me feel uncomfortable. So as a playwright, I did my job. Now, I've given you permission, by talking about this subject matter, to be uncomfortable. Because also the audience, you as audience members, or us as audience members, have responsibility. We have to keep in tune with the world. We have to keep ourselves skinlessly alert. When I belonged to the Met, right? And I was in the American wing, and there was, I forgot the name of this painting, it was a turn of the century painting, last century, yeah? And it was this person painting homeless people. And this woman said, I can't look at this, it's too depressing. Now, the artist did his job. She chose to keep herself ignorant. So at what point does an audience take responsibility as well? Because, you know, I'm not saying that it's utopian when you're talking about Havana, and, you know, when you go to Europe, people, you know, again, are, it's older aesthetically, they don't freak the way a lot of people freak. I mean, that's why a lot of people of color move there. There's a reason for that, man. Because people are much more open in certain ways aesthetically than we are. They're used to stories being told, and they're not afraid to go to that place. So again, it's like you also have people's individual comfort zone when they're in the arts, and they're speaking for the audience. Audiences here were great. Audiences in Chicago were like, you know, people came up to me because what I did, because I realized the subject matter was so heavy. There were incest survivors. There were, you know, all kinds of stuff going on. We, you know, dealt with people from RAIN, the Rape and Incest Network, and I knew as a writer that I did have a certain kind of responsibility. It did open up possibilities. It did open up, you know, dialogue where those people could take that and individuate it and go and talk about it, right? But again, with New York, I was sitting with a certain person. I don't like
Oscar that. Eustace.
Oh, hey, yo. And, I said nothing, man. No. And this person, I love your work. I said, let's just cut to the chase. I said, if you're going to make love to me, do the foreplay. Just don't go straight to the fucker, right? Because I don't have time for you. That's exactly what I said. Sorry for those people, freak, yeah? And so it's, you know, if you're going to do the work, you're going to do the work. I didn't even hear this. And of course, this person did not do this because they were worried about their board members and this kind of stuff. And also, again, it also underrates audiences because, again, I know people in New York that would go for a lot of the work that we're talking about.
But I, you know, one of the big problems I have is these theaters who say these things, and I think it's bullshit.
It's totally.
I think that, you know, they, you know, and I said this at another panel, but it's like they put up all these little graphs and they say, well, if you do this, then you're gonna lose this and that. It's like, no, that's not true. Because every single time I've done a play that was controversial or was a different voice, people love it.
Yeah.
It's like, you are the person who's afraid.
That's exactly what it is.
And you need to let them see what is real.
Yeah.
Because they're aching for it.
They
wanna see it.
But also what happens is, and for those of you, I mean, you know, and people know this, you know, a lot of people have certain board members that are of a certain age because, again, age, it has to be diversified, race, gender, age, right? And so if people are given in, like, a, you know, a certain amount of money, people allow certain board members to have a certain amount of power. And, you know, that's, you can't do that either.
Yeah. Well,
One-way theater in New York is a theater called Rattlesnake. They're doing interesting work.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, they're doing really great work, but I don't know.
Well, I think another thing in terms of... That you talk about the diversity.
Mm.
It's also a class.
Oh, sure.
You know that, I feel like you've got this group of, generally speaking, for most theaters, rich people, who, and it's a theater is normally going to be started by some working class person. That's the original idea. You know, it's a group of people who get together, do something, tell some real stories. And in order to get grants, they got to get a bunch of rich people to sit on the board. And those people from, it's like you've got AT&T on your board, you've got Wells Fargo, and you've got, you know, Chase Manhattan. And there's going to be stuff where they're just going to go, this, we don't know if we can fund this. You know, I had one artistic director come to me after a play I wrote that spent like 5 extended runs, you know, in LA. And artistic director in the Bay Area, comes up, and they rejected my play, same play. And he came up to me at an audition, and he just whispered to me, I really liked your play, but we can't do it.
That gave that a lot as well.
Right, yeah, and I was like, first of all, yes, you can. But
yes.
He was scared.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's like, to reduce somebody who's supposed to be this fearless, you know, artist, and reduce them down to this fearful little person is what a lot of times I think that's why class has to be a part of it.
Know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Stop it. You stop talking about
that's why.
So, I'm gonna speak for a moment. This is an incredibly moving and rich conversation, and there's so much more. There's so much more, and so little time, but I want to do it again, and kind of, we started to edge into the conversation about form, and form, content, and place, and time period, like where we are now, but we are out of time to do that, but I wanted to sort of just leave that with, you know, what you were saying, Kinan, which I'm not sure I completely understood. But only because the theory behind it is something you've developed, and I don't know what that is. But the idea that we have as a country and as a culture transformed to a new time, and that the richness that is in this room and the passion for the work is continuing forward, both within those of us who are older and those of you who are emerging and creating new work that exists in a whole different kind of way, but is still theater. And thank God, doesn't rely upon an artistic director saying yes or no, or a corporate board saying we can fund this or we can't fund that. Mm-hmm. So I think that is so important that Javier and Ryan and all of you who are doing this work and bringing up young people, our children, to be empowered to create. And I'm really excited about that and moving forward. And I hope that you guys know how to keep in touch with each other. And I'm really excited that you guys came, and we're gonna connect in the lobby. There's wine. Yeah. There are some refreshments. Please share the refreshments, please.
There's also a cohort of
there's light snacks.
Yeah.
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 Yeah.